healthy looking here.
Are you blind, Red?
That's what David will be shouting. Not bad for a man who woke up with a sore throat, blocked nose, headache, and feeling all fuzzy. That's new Vicks Action for you. Very effective. Works right at the site of your symptoms, which can be caused by swollen tissues infected by the cold virus. Action reduces the swelling in your nose and helps sort all the other stuff too. So David gets a nice restful day at the footy, and I get to have a quiet afternoon with the girls.
For fast relief of your worst cold and flu symptoms,
it's got to be new Vicks Action.
Alert your senses to the refreshment of Shazam. Shazam, refresh your senses.
Well, now we bring you the Granada match live.
Where's Brian? Is he birthday boy with us? Oh, there you are. All right, come along.
Table for nine, please. We have booked.
It's right, gentlemen. It's right.
Yeah, here we are. Oh. What time's the kissogram showing up?
Yellow Pages, supporters of the Granada match live.
This week's Granada match live represents the keen and competitive nature of the First Division. The table suggests a home banker until you examine it more closely. It's a game which could be full of surprises.
It only took a moment, a flash of inspiration 13 years ago, and Graham Sharp's days of being an unknown rookie were over.
Sharp! Oh my goodness! You won't see a better one than that!
It's approaching 12 months since he joined the ranks of being a rookie again, succeeding another Everton number 9 of distinction, Joe Royle, as Oldham's manager. His most recent signing is another Goodison old boy, Paul Wilkinson, considered surplus to requirements at Middlesbrough now that Juninho's arrived on Teesside. Port Vale, like manager John Rudge, have been hobbling this season.
Morning.
The good afternoons have been far from Vale Park. They haven't won at home, but for some reason their away form spells danger.
And we've played very well away from home and got results. At home we haven't played badly. We just don't seem to manage to get a result in front of our home supporters, which is obviously very frustrating, because normally you do get quite a few points at home and you're still away. Let's hope it continues today and we can get a good result at Oldham.
The Granada match live comes with a guarantee of goals. Depending on today, there's something in excess of 75, including another three from Preston's stylish Savile Row. Very good afternoon to you. It's Oldham, comfortably placed against Port Vale, who are bottom, but whose away form compares with the best in the division. Strange, isn't it? Well, full of explanations throughout the afternoon. Such an Oldham hero, they used to call him Andy Famous there.
Picked on by Bunn. Ritchie!
A few of those this afternoon. Andy Ritchie, good to have you with us. Andy will be having a go at the competition very shortly. Your chance to have a go to win the dough. 0891 4-0, 5-0, 8-0. Predict the score of this afternoon's game between Oldham and Port Vale and you could win £200. The lines are open until 4 o'clock or thereabouts. Basically the first kick of the second half. And for the five runners-up, you'll each receive a copy of this book. Great for all you statos out there. The Guinness Football Factbook. Right, Andy, you'll be in distinguished company if you get it hopelessly wrong, but have a crack. What do you think it's going to be? What's the score?
No doubt I will, but it's usually an entertaining game. I'll go for 3-1 for Oldham.
Oldham 3, Port Vale 1. That's Andy Ritchie's prediction. What do you think? Ring in and enter the competition. Right now, it's time to go over to Boundary Park live and join our commentary team of Jim Beglin and John Helm.
Thank you very much, Elton. Good afternoon, everyone. Well, our studio guest got the score absolutely right last week. That was Dave Bassett. Let's hope Andy's just as successful. There's a huge incentive for both these teams. If Oldham win, they'll leap six places up the first division to seventh. If Vale win, they'll move out of the bottom two. Well, Graham Sharp suffered a blow this morning when his influential skipper Nick Henry failed a test. He has a back problem. So Richard Graham moves from centre-back to midfield. And the other change sees Ian Snowden move to full-back for the suspended Scott McNiven, with Steve Redmond coming in at centre-back. Paul Wilkinson, a journeyman striker who once partnered Sharp in the Everton attack, is on loan from Middlesbrough and makes his home debut. Port Vale are happy to be playing away from home because, while they haven't won a single game at Vale Park, they've lost only twice on their travels. Their two changes give Stuart Talbot a chance in midfield at the expense of Ray Walker, and Lee Mills a return in attack with Lee Gubber dropping to substitute. Tony Naylor has suddenly been promoted from a regular on the bench to the club's number one striker. He hasn't scored since April, but he's rated the man in form by manager John Rudge. Our referee today comes from Preston, not far away, and he is Phil Richards. Jim Beglin alongside me. We said last week at Norwich what a lovely surface it was. This is another piece of turf you'd love to be playing on.
Absolutely glorious, John. They've had their problems here in past seasons at Bendry Park, but they've uprooted it during the summer, and it couldn't be in better nick.
That's Guppy's ball down the line. And Port Vale, much to their credit, I always think, do play with two wingers even away from home in McCarthy and Guppy. That's going to go dead. So it gives another chance, Jim, for you to assess this game, which, as I said, has plenty of incentive for both teams.
Well, Oldham have been very steady this season. Graham Sharp has done a good job, really. They're tighter at the back, but they're not really firing as many goals they should be. Speaking to some of the players before the game, they'd like to improve in that department. Port Vale, John Rudge is baffled as to why they're doing better away from home. But I actually, any time I've seen them, John, I think they counter very well. They're able to sit back and soak up pressure. And as you say, playing the wingers, they get it wide and they can break fast.
Thank you, Jim. There's Wilkinson's first touch of this game. A little header, a deft one too. And that ball spins away. And Richardson, and the ball flying in the end off Mark Brennan and just out of play for the goal kick. That would have been a real fluke if that had gone in.
Well, we've seen a few go in like that, but I think Paul Musselwhite this time was actually ready for it. And I think he had it covered all the way.
Headed on by Mills. And then that's Porter's pass. Hallett. One for Wilkinson to chase. And any player who's on loan, I always think, has to show plenty of enthusiasm, especially on a home debut. So even though Paul Wilkinson's the wrong side of 30, he's going to give it everything today.
I'm sure he will. I'm sure Graham Sharp said to him, look, even though you're match fit, give it everything. I can always take you off.
And he's in there now, and he gets a good flick through, and Oldham tees something up here. And they're still tussling for it on the edge of that Port Vale area. And the one thing Port Vale can't afford today is to concede an early goal. And McCarthy will hustle the Port Vale defender Tankard in here. He didn't get a corner out of it, but he did get a throw in. The brisk beginning from the Latics. We've got the Latics against the Valiants today, for those who love club nicknames. And here's the Norwegian Haller with the long throw. Guppy's clearance. That might be a bruising battle today, Mills and Redmond. Dean Glover, former Sheffield United and Aston Villa defender, who's been a fixture in this Port Vale defence for 3 or 4 years now. Talbot, who's very competitive in Port Vale's midfield, and it's booted in the air. Tankard will come to meet it. Came off Haller, who disputes the fact. Now a bit of space for Guppy, who crosses a good ball if he can find the space. Mills the one to make himself available, but beaten away rather easily. Angled across here for Haller. Must say how nice it is, Jim, to see a game played on grass here. We all remember the plastic surface, which obviously had its financial reasons behind it, but it's much nicer to see a game on grass.
Definitely, John. I played on this plastic pitch here a couple of times, and I wasn't a fan of the plastic. I'm a far bigger fan of grass any day. It was never easy on my dodgy knees either.
No, I used to get a few burns as well. Well, the Oldham fans didn't like that, but it was the safe option for Redmond. Griffiths, who's 6 feet four, gets his head in there first. And Talbot's ball, a rather lax one, putting his own man under some pressure. Guppy again. It's good going forward, but not a good deliverer of the pass that time.
I think Oldham are aware that Guppy's a man that can cause him problems, and closing him down.
John Rudge, manager of Port Vale, has been on crutches for the last few weeks, but happily dispensed with those now. Snowden's the captain today, and it means he's captained every single club he's been at. Doncaster, Leeds, Everton, and now captain of Oldham Athletic today in the absence of Nick Henry. And he's very proud of that fact.
Well, he's a good, solid performer, Ian Snowden. He's been very unlucky in his career, John. Not long after the move to Everton, he was in an England squad, never made it because of injury, and I'm glad to see that he's doing well again.
Had to be cleared by Gerrard. Graham Sharp, who doesn't play as much as he would like to do. I don't think we're likely to see much of Graham Sharp in first team action again now. It's a very difficult job to be a player manager, and he's quite content to just take on the one role these days. Haller, a long throw and an intelligent one, because it's almost a touch finder down there, and they make ground. Well, it was Bjorn Wilkinson, and it almost got through to Sean McCarthy behind him. And there's Gareth Griffiths, who's come to Port Vale from non-league football in Wales and really made a name for himself. Hallett. Wilkinson with the flick. It'll come back to him! And from the most acute of angles, Paul Wilkinson rejoices. A debut goal at Boundary Park for his manager to appreciate. And Paul Wilkinson looks to the heavens, and he really belted that one in from no more than 5 yards out.
Well, we almost saw a goal similar to that from Mark Brennan earlier on. Haller takes the throw in. It's flicked on by Wilkinson. He turns around, and it's Dean Yates hasn't cleared it. Dean Glover, I should say, hasn't cleared it. And Paul Wilkinson's the man in there again. Flicked on from the throw in. Didn't hang about, followed it up. Glover didn't clear it. Good goal from Wilkinson.
Typical striker's goal, actually, wasn't it? And here they come again. Haller's into the area and had a chance to make it too. No goalkeeper on earth would have stopped that one from Wilkinson.
I don't think the goalkeeper was expecting it. I think he expected his centre half to clear it quite easily, but it was a poor clearance, or attempt at clearance from Glover, and keeper could do nothing about it. And Guller Haller, very next attack, well, he scuffed the shot. It was another good opportunity.
Well, I did say that the last thing Port Vale needed this afternoon was to concede a goal in the early phases of this game. When you're down at the bottom, that's the last thing you want. And Oldham attack again. McCarthy's little lock back is to Richardson. McCarthy again. They're queuing up here. And, well, Paul Musselwhite, that's the third shot at him in the space, well, I would say, in less than 2 minutes.
Well, I mean, before that, neither side had really settled. It was a bit scrappy, trying to settle down. But Oldham, since they got the goal, full of confidence now. And again, similar to the effort we've seen just before, scuffed the ground a little bit. That one was easy for Musselwhite.
Port Vale have a free kick, though, as they bid to get back into this game. It's good to see an early goal in a game, I always think. Helps to set it up and gets the fans excited. Port Vale know they've got to come back now, and Naylor tries to get in. Oldham won this corresponding fixture 3-2 last December with a hat-trick from a certain Andy Ritchie. I'm sure he'd love to be out here today. That was an important interception by Tankard, and he's played a good ball forward for Naylor, who whips it back across there. Cleared first time by Redmond. Very lively start.
Well, it is a lively start. Well, the thing is now, if Port Vale had thought about maybe sitting back and hitting Oldham on the break, they can forget about it now, John, because they've conceded that early goal. They've got to come at them and try and get back in it.
Dean Glover. Mills is a target man to aim for. It's a decent knock back from him, and not the best of clearances either from Graham. Richardson will try and find Wilkinson, but that ball holding up, it's a problem. The goalkeeper couldn't handle it there, and they got themselves into all sorts of trouble there through indecision between centre-back and goalkeeper. And Guppy's done well to win the ball off Hallett. Graham. And some relief for Port Vale. Much needed relief at the moment too.
Well, I don't know what the goalkeeper was thinking about there, John. I felt he never should have come off his line. He came way out of his goal. I never really had a hope of getting. He could have allowed Griffiths to deal with it. He's given him a shout. Griffiths allowed it to go. And I think had Wilkinson been more committed a little earlier there, Vale could have been two down.
Fortune was on their side, and now they attack. Tidied up by Snuddin, and then Haller steps on the ball, and that allows the captain Porter to win it. McCarthy down the line for Hill. It's a beautiful sunny afternoon at Boundary Park. It hasn't always been like this when I've been here, mind you. They say it's the second highest ground in the country. You of course know which is the highest, Jim.
No, I don't.
It's the Hawthorns at West Brom, surprisingly, actually. But it's a bit sharp here. The sharper still by 20-5. Tankard. Has to elude Mr. Richards, first of all. McCarthy, good ball in, but just too far for Naylor. I think already John McCarthy's become a little frustrated. He's a right winger and he's not had the ball out there yet, so he'd come in field seeking it. Musselwhite, and he's got to be confident this time. Glover loses possession to McCarthy, and Port Vale are their own worst enemies at the moment. It's knocked in for Wilkinson again. Little touch from him, booted away by Porter. But Port Vale are really committing a few defensive sins.
Yeah, they're making problems for themselves. Musselwhite could have cleared that upfield. He put Glover in trouble, but McCarthy and Wilkinson are working so hard to close them down, and they're not letting him out.
Brennan's cross, straight up in the air from Griffiths. McCarthy's underneath it too. Trouble back there at the moment. This was the mix-up again.
Well, again, Sean McCarthy's done so well in the corner. Wilkinson in there on the near post, but just before Brennan can get there, Porter managed to clear, but Vale are not looking good back there at the moment. They're all over the place.
Well, that's definitely the highest. That will come down with snow on it from Redmond. Nobody wanted to head that one. Up towards Naylor. Good control from Talbot, but still unable to knock the ball through to anybody in a white shirt. Naylor must pursue this one. Paul Gerrard has really cemented his position here ahead of John Hallworth. He's been the regular for the last three seasons now. Glover. And then Haller gets in, so here is McCarthy, shadowed by Griffiths, and a free kick awarded against the tall Oldham, the tall Port Vale centre back, who's had an uncertain start. Fleming is going to take this one. Fleming up towards McCarthy. Appeals for a handball there, but Mr. Richards saw nothing wrong. Brennan. What a high ball's been played around at the moment. And at long last, it's back on the carpet, and Guppy, it's a silly pass, really. He'd all the time in the world and played it straight out to Snowden. And then coming in on the blind side is McCarthy, and that did look like a handball by Hill. Nothing given. Well, he certainly seemed to control it with something other than his body there.
Well, he was caught out there. I don't actually think he knew that McCarthy was behind him, put him under pressure. There was a suspicion of a handball there.
Whipped across by Haller. McCarthy, a free header, right across goal, and the Port Vale defence is at sixes and sevens.
Well, here it is coming in. It's just, oh, I think it's actually, he's played it in his...
Yeah, it is, to be fair to him, that's definitely not a handball. It's an awkward moment for Andy Hill. Good flick from Mills. Well, John Rudge hurt himself in a bizarre training accident several weeks ago. He was simply throwing a ball, and he snapped an Achilles tendon since when he's been on crutches until this week. He's managed to dispense with them, but he's not going to be able to take part in training for several more weeks. Haller's won the ball back again, a bad mistake. Straight past Wilkinson. Here's Brennan. Oh, he can really tee up another one here. At full stretch, Griffiths clears. Only as far as Makin. Graham battles on, and it's a strange try from Richard Graham. When you look to hit it with the left foot, he had a bit of a toe poke, and Rudge doesn't like that because they're getting so much space, Oldham.
Well, he loves that position, Richard Graham. He's been playing a centre-back recently, but he loves to play in that central midfield role and get forward. And here, saw the keeper just off his line. He certainly meant that, flicked it with the outside of his right foot, and he wasn't very far away.
It was a very intelligent piece of football from Graham, who's been playing at centre-back in recent weeks. He may not have been in the starting lineup today, but for Nick Henry's injury. This free kick is for Port Vale. They haven't really got into the game at all. No, they're still on the bus, aren't
they?
They're
still making trouble for themselves, John. It has to be said that all came from Dean Glover again, being slow on the ball, giving it away, looking to get away with it.
Now they're in the game. There's going to be an offside flag here. Lee Mills, the £200,000 signing from Derby County, former Wolves player. Well, the first quarter of an hour has belonged exclusively to Oldham Athletic, and it's no exaggeration to say they could be out of sight already.
Well, we just saw a picture of Lee Mills screaming at his defenders, and he's got to be telling them they must release it quicker, because Oldham are up for this. They're closing them down all the time, and they've got to be far faster with their distribution.
Richardson knocks another ball in here. McCarthy underneath, it swings, and that would have been a really spectacular goal if it had gone under instead of over the crossbar. Very, very good try from McCarthy.
Well, that's good striking, that, from McCarthy. He's a big man. He's managed to hold off Andy Hill. Great strength from, and then he swivels on the proverbial sixpence. And again, that wasn't too far over.
It's a clean strike from a man in form. McCarthy, last season's top scorer here. And certainly in the hunt for goals early in this match. McCarthy back to Hill. Now Mills, and he controls it well, and that's a raw, that's a superb strike from Lee Mills. What a goal. We've just seen McCarthy at the one end, and Port Vale out of nothing have grabbed an equaliser. Spectacular stuff from Lee Mills.
Well, that's amazing, Joe. That's come out of nothing. A rare Port Vale attack. The ball is played into Mills. Fleming and Redmond are each side of him. He does extremely well to control it. And again, just like McCarthy before, it swiveled, it bounced for him, saw the keeper off his line, right into the top corner. That is a wonderful goal.
A brilliant goal by Lee Mills, his fifth of the season, and he's responded to being dropped last week. He's back all right. Oh, great start to the match. Two goals in it already, and Oldham have a corner now. But Lee Mills will be thrilled. That's probably, I would say, the best goal he's ever struck. Corner for Oldham Athletic. Pegged back to 1-1, and they must wonder why they're not out of sight already. They'll have another corner. He's happier than he was 2 minutes ago, without showing it. Locked deep this time. Here comes Redmond. Didn't get a connection on the ball at all. Well, that goal certainly should lift Port Vale, although that's a sloppy pass in midfield.
It was just so out of the blue, John. I mean, they'd done absolutely nothing before that. McCarthy, you'd said, was frustrated. Guppy had seen little of the ball. They just couldn't really feed their strikers. And the ball was played in from the right. And Lee Mills did so well. I think he was slightly fortunate when you see it come in. Craig Fleming just gets his foot round it, plays it into him. It helps him to control it. And once it bounced in front of him, he didn't hang about.
It was certainly something Gerrard didn't expect in goal. To be fair, I don't think many people around the ground expected it. It was very, very good centre forward play. Hill now, and here's Naylor. And they've suddenly found a way to break through Oldham's defences. Well, I have to say, I usually see a few goals when I come to Boundary Park, and they're not letting us down. 20 minutes played, and a one apiece. Naylor, Talbot, now Guppy. And you can see the confidence beginning to flood through Port Vale. Well, that's not a great ball. It gives Graham the chance to clear up to Wilkinson. That's intelligent centre forward play. Knew exactly where Gunnar Haller was. And only one in the area at the moment for Haller, so it's Snuddin. And it all broke down. And so Port Vale come again with Guppy. Well, Wilkinson's pulled up there, otherwise I think he might have intercepted that ball. As it's Naylor into the area, played back by Redmond. But I think Wilkinson's got a problem there.
Well, he did so well to play the ball wide when Oldham tried to break to Gunnar Haller. Eventually possession broke down, but Griffiths was laid on him, and Griffiths has now been booked. I think this is good refereeing. And the ball was played up to Wilkinson, he's controlled it, released it. Griffiths came late and caught him. That's why he was down. And actually, he missed that ball as Vale tried to come forward there, because he just literally stood up again.
Well spotted, Jim. Well spotted, Mr. Richards. Now on with the action at one apiece. And Redmond under pressure from Naylor, but it was a foul by Tony Naylor. That was all down to the linesman on that far side who spotted that. Gareth Griffiths booked, and deservedly so. This is why.
There it is. I mean, Wilkinson was playing it away. Griffiths knew he wasn't going to be able to get there, still followed through, and he caught the Oldham striker.
Quality ball from Snowden up to Wilkinson, who's recovered quickly. The Oldham fans thought he was being tugged when he whips the ball across. It's Hill who picks it up and just keeps it in play. There's nobody in a blue shirt anywhere near.
I think if Oldham want to get back into this game, well, they've got to feed McCarthy and Wilkinson as early as possible, because they've got Glover and Griffiths in a bit of a muddle back there, and they're certainly getting the better of it.
Haller's ball intercepted, and the quick transfer up front sees Naylor coming up against two men, and making, and Naylor's battled away well. Here's Mills again. Naylor. And suddenly it's Oldham who are looking a little bit of distress at the back. But it's curious, isn't it? Two teams who haven't been noted for prolific goal scoring this season, but they're both looking very capable of scoring today. Oh, taken on here by McCarthy. But, straight out of play. Sean McCarthy with 7 goals so far this season. Scored last week at Derby in the defeat. He's had a good goal scoring record throughout his career. John Rudge on his right, by the way, Bill Dearden, his assistant manager, who's not a great lover of Sunday football. Port Vale have played on 3 of the last 4 Sundays. He said he'd rather be at home tending his vegetable patch.
He's probably thinking that again when Oldham took the lead earlier on, but he'll be a little bit happier, as will Rudge now.
Fleming away by Hallett, and then Brennan. Hallett locks it long, McCarthy underneath it. Hill just wins the challenge. Brennan keeps it in. And it's an easy claim for Musselwhite, who's only just regained his place in the first team from Arjan van Hoosden, the Dutchman. But he has been a regular for the past 3 or 4 seasons now at Vale Park. So a storming header forward, Mills is offside. Talbot's a tall fella in midfield for Port Vale. Mills is a big man up front, so they've got some height in there. Griffiths with the header. No foul, and Oldham can continue this move with McCarthy's header, looking for a link up with Wilkinson. Oldham 1, Port Vale 1, midway through the first half at Boundary Park. And there's the Oldham goal scorer. He's got goals wherever he's been too. I was saying that about McCarthy a moment ago. Well, Paul Wilkinson, ever since he started at Grimsby Town, has been a regular 20 goals a season man. Notably at Middlesbrough recently. Corner kick. Now Richardson delivers these, and from that angle you can see how many white shirts are going to be back there. Indeed, only Tony Naylor is not inside the Port Vale penalty area. They've left only one up. Richardson floats it in. Hallett, McCarthy, and it just didn't bounce for him. Otherwise, it might well have been Oldham 2, Port Vale 1.
Well, there were two opportunities to try and get in on that one. Haller was the one on the near post. When it comes in, he's the one that could have maybe got up a little higher to flick it. And McCarthy has just gone in a little bit too quickly. And it's just bounced behind him.
McCarthy just getting ahead of the ball there. So he represented Wales, not at the top level, but then strangely was hoping to get a Republic of Ireland place in the last World Cup. Shows you can play for anybody these days. Big Jack will have noted that.
Yeah, Sean is actually, he was over for a couple of squad sessions, but nothing has developed ever since.
Talbot. Glover long. Mills coming in behind Redmond. Steve Redmond, who was Player of the Year for Oldham Athletic last season, but has been in a bit of dispute and has not been guaranteed a first team place this season.
Nice man to have around to come in though. He's an experienced campaigner back there, and it was a nice cool piece of defending for him.
This time Tankard hits it long, and there's a good run made by Mills, the Vale scorer. He loses out this time. And there is that composed figure of Steve Redmond driving Oldham forward, but it was a poor ball from Brennan. gives Port Vale the chance, and here's the other McCarthy in the match. John, good ball in here, Naylor first time. And I would have thought that Graham Sharp would be a little alarmed there at the ease with which McCarthy found Naylor inside the penalty area.
Well, you can tell he looks a bit upset with that. McCarthy was able to play it in, and when it comes in, Naylor's just got far too much room. Fleming sat off 2 or 3 yards from him. And had he hit that better, Paul Gerrard wouldn't have had it quite so easy.
Well, Fleming has the reputation of being one of the best man-to-man markers in the game. Let Naylor get some space there. Now it's Guppy. Port Vale have chances here. Tankard's out wide. Mills is calling for it at the back post, and it spins away off a blue boot. And in a muddle of players, there's going to be a free kick for Naylor's challenge on Gerrard.
I think the referee has got that one right. Gerrard was always going to get there first, and when he did, Naylor was a little rash, slid in. As Gerrard tried to grab it in his hands, he's caught him. And yeah, I think the referee was right to give the free kick on that one.
Tony Naylor was such a prolific scorer in his Crewe Alexandra days. He only made a short move to Port Vale, but he's not quite found the target as often. Playing at a higher level, of course. Although, who knows, Crewe could be up for next season. The way they're going this time. That's Porter challenging to win the ball, but it's a throw-in nonetheless, and Haller knocks it forward. Snowden nearly got caught there by Talbot. Good shielding of the ball from Mills. Talbot's got nowhere to go. Tankard, Mills again, and Talbot's made a run into that area. On he goes, and he's tripped. Surely tripped. Penalty kick. No question at all in the mind of Mr. Richards, and I don't think there's going to be any complaint from any of the Oldham defenders either. Penalty won by Talbot, an enthusiastic run from midfield, controlled it well, and Richard Graham is the forlorn defender.
Well, Graham Sharp won't be happy again. The long ball over the top, the Oldham defence went missing for a while, and Richard Graham, he was pulling his shirt and he just clipped his ankles. Had to be a penalty.
To take it, it'll be Andy Porter. He's got 3 goals this season, 2 of them from the penalty spot, and Port Vale failed to take the lead because he clips the upright. Well, that is a real blown opportunity by the Port Vale captain.
Well, normally when you see players taking penalty kicks and they go for power, they normally just try and blast it straight at the middle in the hope the keeper's going to move. That time Porter tried to pick out the left corner, and he's just pulled across it outside of the post. What a letter for Oldham.
Glover away. Well, they will regard that as a major let off Oldham Athletic. Haller. Corner for Oldham. Well, there's certainly going to be plenty for Elton and Andy Ritchie to talk about during the half-time interval. Corner kick. Brennan for Oldham. And plenty happening in this match, and it's flicked through here. Redmond had the shot. Charged down. Now Graham, and he could well have made amends for conceding the penalty very rapidly there. I bet he's a relieved young man at the moment.
Most definitely. But again, in that position where he likes to get just on the edge of the box. When it first comes in here, it's only half cleared. Steve Redmond tries to get the volley in. Glover does well to come and block. Eventually, when it comes out to Graham, it was a difficult chance for him. Swiveled well, couldn't keep it down.
Port Vale's free kick. Well, there's plenty of hustle and bustle in this game. There's been a lot said about the English game in the last 7 days. Since our European failures, but this is the sort of football the fans love. Porter tries to make up for his penaltiness. Can't do so. And it's Graham again who breaks for Oldham. Can he find McCarthy? Yes, he can. On goes McCarthy, but we'll lose out eventually to Hill.
Yeah, Yeah, you could probably question the quality of football at times, John, but there's no question the effort and the commitment, the endeavour from both sides. It's like a cup tie out there. It's good stuff.
Yeah, it's the passion. That's what the English fans love, isn't it? They don't always like the slow continental build-up. They're not getting that today.
No chance.
But as I say, plenty to talk about. 1-1 it is. A penalty miss as well. So many of these fans will have had their roast beef in Yorkshire and then come up here to Boundary Park, and they're seeing a cracking match to follow it. And here's Richardson, and that struck his own man, Haller. He might have another go, and he's got a good shot on him, but this time it dribbles through to Musselwhite. And I know you have a feeling, haven't you, that Richardson should probably score more goals than he does.
I think he should. I went to Blackburn on loan a few years back. Richardson was there, and he's got so much promise. He's such a good player. And he probably can't produce it as consistently as certainly Graham Sharp would like at the moment. That time, I think it was just clipped on the way, took the sting out of it. Musselwhite was easily able to gather it again.
Backing in is the offence committed by Mills this time. Predictably argues the point, most players do. He felt he got a bang on the knot on the head. Wilkinson, Richardson, and if it comes to him here, he's in a good shooting position. Comes instead to Snowden. That'll be beyond Wilkinson. Imagine Graham Sharp's very happy though that Wilkinson didn't have to come off when he just seemed to get a bit of a knock a few minutes ago. But it's one of the oldest cliches, of course, that there are no easy games, and Graham Sharp's side are finding that out against the bottom club in the division already. They could be behind. Away by Dean Glover. That formidable figure of Redmond's there to swing another one in. Musselwhite, 44 appearances last season, more than anyone at Port Vale. Both these sides playing 4-4-2 formations today, so he knows exactly where to hit the ball. And he found Guppy, but straight out. Actually, Guppy's not really been in position to do much down the left flank today.
No, he hasn't been given it. Ian Snowden's had quite an easy afternoon, as Chris Makin has on the other side, because John McCarthy's seen little of it either.
Correct. Snowden again. That's good play from Oldham between Haller and McCarthy. But they were always at full stretch. Mills trying to get behind Redmond, and he does that, but Makin's covered. Talbot, who won that penalty. Tankard. And again, it's Talbot who's got him into the area, and Graham will be very wary of going near him. So Guppy knocks the ball in, but it wasn't a good cross. The ball bounced awkwardly, and then Haller does knock it forward. Wilkinson will gallop after it. And the keeper's back on his line as Oldham build with Makin. Richardson. Snowden. Now he's got some room, and there are plenty of people up in the area. Beyond Wilkinson, McCarthy, and across goal it goes. The keeper off his line would have had no hope of saving that, and he would have been acutely embarrassed if the ball had gone in the net.
I'm not so sure whether he actually got a touch on that. Good ball in from Snowden, the header from McCarthy. Maybe the goalkeeper did get a touch to deflect it away from goal.
Oldham will have a free kick in a useful position here, because Tankard shoved into Hallett.
Well, we're going to find out now whether he got a touch on or not. Good ball in from Snowden again. And I think he did, John. The keeper did get there. You've got to give him credit for that one.
Yep. Fair dues. McCarthy's going to be in there looking again now, alongside the muscular Wilkinson. And Mills is just being spoken to by Mr. Richards. There's the long and the short of it.
I think he's still moaning about that decision given against him a few moments ago.
Brilliant Brennan to swing it in. Graham the header. Well, he found some space at the back post. He's a central figure in the game at the moment, Richard Graham.
Well, if anything, he should have been trying to head that back across goal, because to try and score from there, well, it's asking a little bit much. And McCarthy and Wilkinson have got themselves in the six-yard box. But it looks as if he just tried to sneak it inside that near post. And Sean McCarthy saying to him, should have tried to pick me out.
Brennan, first time ball up to McCarthy, and he tried to be a little too clever probably with that one, but it's only been played out to Snowden again. McCarthy's calling for it, and it's too far ahead of him. Didn't quite get the angle. I've seen McCarthy score from exactly those sort of situations, just outside the area, spinning on it and hitting a shot first time. Naylor. Now McCarthy, who's had no service at all on that right flank.
Well, Graham Sharp.
Oh, what's Musselwhite doing here? Terrible goalkeeping, really, that. Taking on Wilkinson in that situation. And John Rudge would have been furious with his goalkeeper if Oldham had scored then.
Well, earlier in the game it was happening with his defenders. And here Musselwhite should have been looking to play that much earlier. Wilkinson put him under pressure. And he was so lucky just to get a toe on it, to get it away.
He's laughing now. Now then, he might not be. This Haller's here. Into the area he goes. It's away. Wilkinson rather snapped at it. And it flies high over the top. But all the action is at this end of the ground. And Jim, why would a goalkeeper do a thing like he did a minute ago? I don't understand it.
Well, they do daft things. I mean, we're never going to be able to figure that one out. And Wilkinson, he was leaning slightly back there, got under it, ballooned it over the bar. But I was going to say before, Graham Sharp's probably delighted that Vale haven't got their wingers into the game today. But the worrying thing from Oldham's point of view at times is that Vale have played long balls in the back, in between their centre-backs and full-backs, and Port Vale have just looked a little bit dangerous doing that.
Well, there goes Mills again, and he's been a bit of a handful at times. Porter into Talbot, who's also been a handful, and he careers on again towards the edge of that area, and he's a real battler, is Talbot. Well, they've certainly found Talbot hard to contain at times when he's made those forward runs.
Well, he likes to do what Richard Graham does for Oldham and get into the box to support the strikers at every opportunity, winning the penalty, and he's done it on several other occasions as well.
McCarthy into Guppy. Well, there's a bit of space there, but surrounded by blue shirts now, so he slips it wide for Tankard, and the ball into a poor one again. Tankard, the former Wigan and Southampton fullback, linking again with Guppy, who delivers a much better cross, except that there was nobody in a white shirt anywhere near the goalkeeper. If Mills is onside here, they might be in trouble. He might get the better of Makin. He's surely got to supply McCarthy. No? Keeps on going himself. And in the end, fritters the opportunity, really. He held the ball up well. But Oldham have a man McCarthy down. Not quite sure what happened to Sean McCarthy there, to be fair.
Well, it looks like he's taken a knock to the head, somewhere on his head, but I'm with you, John. I didn't see why he went down either.
So much for him to think about, and of course it's about this stage in the half they start to think about what they're going to say to the boys in the dressing room to try and bring a victory out of, at the moment, what is only a draw. Now, I think we can have a look at what happened. Thank goodness for VT replays. Still don't look to be anything serious, did they, really?
Well, it didn't, unless it's Griffith's left arm that just came in and caught him.
Certainly doesn't look to be anything too serious. need for the stretcher bearers, thankfully. Well met by Dean Glover, equally well met by Snowden. And then a miss kick by Glover this time, so Oldham do have the chance just to tee something up before the break. Mills, nice little touch through. Naylor's offside as Talbot tried to locate him up there. Brennan up for McCarthy. Obviously all right again. He hadn't continued his run. Hill's got to be sure what he does here, and he played the ball straight back to Brennan. And here comes Wilkinson with the header. Didn't get any purchase on it. But he's a battler, is Paul Wilkinson.
He is. He makes it awkward for the defender. Similar to Graham Sharp, can hold it up well. But when this came in, again, he was slightly ahead of it. He had to try and arch his neck around it. And it was always going to be very hard for him to try and steer that between the posts.
Paul Wilkinson was a regular in the Middlesbrough side. Actually played his last game for Middlesbrough on this ground last season. His substitute, and I don't think he was too happy with Brian Robson for leaving him out at that stage. Well, that worked out nicely for Snowden, who knows that McCarthy and Wilkinson are both up front. That's a terrific ball into McCarthy, it really was. And it's a good job for Port Vale that Griffiths is 6 feet four. But that's a shocking clearance to give the ball back to Gunnar Haller. The deep cross, here's Wilkinson, he was at full stretch. Oldham still in possession though, making. But that indeed is half-time here at Boundary Park. It got off to a cracking start because Paul Wilkinson, from the most acute of angles, belted Oldham in front on his home debut after only 6 minutes. But then Port Vale came back with an equaliser, a stunning shot from Lee Mills, since when Andy Porter has missed a penalty for Port Vale. They could have been in front, but half-time here is Oldham Athletic 1, Port Vale 1.
Right, we've got your cement, we've got your forward tools, we've got your screws, we've got... do you want to deliver in?
Yes, please.
Yellow Pages, supporters of the Granada match live.
I mean, Kitty at the hairdresser's. Anyway, she did go, and she said, I want my hair dyed blonde. Well, what do you think? It came out copper, my dear, copper. I said to her, I said, Kitty, you can't have your hair copper. Oh, yes, she said. I can, she said, so I said, no, you can't.
Get your baking noticed again with the butter-like taste of New Stork Rich Blend.
Everyone's after James Bond, and the Daily Mirror's got him. Play GoldenEye Lottery and make a killing only with the Daily Mirror tomorrow.
In Starland, people are made from deliciously light and bubbly chocolate from Milky Way. Here's Bright Star with a bright idea. New Milky Way Magic Stars. The magic's in the Milky Way.
Radio Rentals, making a major decision needn't be a major headache. We make it so easy for you to rent or buy a quality washing machine. There's great service, and with monthly payments starting at just $12.99, what are you waiting for?
They're suggesting with all this fibre rubbish, pot noodle is some sort of faffy food. So, to see if people who like faffy food like pot noodle, we've come to a leisure centre. Let's go, come on.
Oh, do, gentlemen. Just come to see if you'd like some delicious pot noodle. What are you doing?
We're trying to play a game here.
It's too gorgeous for a...
I saw that. Yeah, that's something the server's going here.
Oh, he's having a barbecue in here. Do you want a bit of pot noodle, man?
Oh, forget it. You'll never find his mouth.
Do you want some pot noodle? Sorry?
Please leave.
I'm performing an experiment.
So, proof that pot noodle is not faffy food.
Gorgeous.
F&D International, leaflets printed. Just putting it through to production.
Keep them talking, no way.
Ah, talking pages. Hello, talking pages.
Yes, we can do that, yes.
There are three printers in your area. No problem. Delivery.
Dispatch.
And we need to hire a van. Van hire.
When your business needs to find another business, remember, talking pages is just a free phone call away.
From Munich.
Munich.
Munich. Okay.
Tuesday. Okay. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Talking Pages. Call free 24 hours a day on 0800 600 900.
My mail delivery stops here. My business is over there. In Britain, the mail comes to your door. What a concept.
Pero si solo quiero unos cheques de viaje.
Esto es una oficina de correo, no un banco.
Back home, you can get traveler's checks in the post office.
Yeah, but they're all mad over there.
Do we have the most efficient postal service in Europe? No, you probably do. But we have won the World Cup more times.
Wonderful. 48 hours ago, this package left Severton, and I have no idea where Severton is.
Wherever you do business, remember, with the post office, it's sorted.
I don't know how you do it. I know you make those rock bands, and they're always very hard, but this is a sponge beyond renown. It's marvellous. You on your pension, how you do it, I don't know. I think it's absolutely wonderful. I really do. Because the whole thing... Yes?
Shut up.
Get your baking noticed again with the butter-like taste of New Stork Rich Blend.
Oh, I must get some treatment for this bald patch. What are you staring at?
Yellow Pages, supporters of the Granada match live.
Welcome back, and what a lively old 45 minutes. It really was one-way traffic to start with, Andy, wasn't it?
It was. I didn't think that the Port Vale defence had played together this season. They were at sixes and sevens.
You'd never have thought they'd only conceded six goals away from home this season before this happened. A Paul Wilkinson goal that you'd have been proud of. It had the Andy Ritchie trademark written all over it, isn't it?
Yes, I mean, it comes in, and I don't think the defender was really ready for it, but it's a great finish. He reacted to it well, and I don't think the goalkeeper had any chance with that.
It's the speed of the reaction, really, isn't
yeah,
it?
Yeah, you see, Glover's just miscontrolled it, and he's got in on it very well.
Now, I think, you say, Oldham, after about 15 minutes, could have been 3-0 up, and the chance that really brought you to your feet was Sean McCarthy. You were applauding this.
Oh, yeah, I mean, Sean's presence of mind and the strength to keep the defender off him. And it's a great strike. He's very unlucky with that.
Now, that was the point we were saying here, that, they should be killing them off, which is...
Exactly, yeah. I mean, they've had quite a few chances, and I'm sure that Graham and Oldham themselves will be thinking that maybe they should have had two or three goals there. And really, you know, they've not taken advantage of it.
Yeah, and of course, so often happens in football, when you don't kill the team off, this sort of thing happens at the other end.
Exactly. Well, it's a bit of a long ball, but he's...
Actually, we saw him score a similar goal last season against Tranmere. Terrific.
He's been a little bit lucky. Craig's tried to clear it, and it's hit him. But, I mean, you can't argue with the finish. What a great presence of mind, and another smashing volley.
I mean, I think Oldham has something like 70% of the possession, and yet Port Vale might have gone into one in front if they converted the penalty kick. I mean, there again, that's the nature of football, isn't it?
It is, yeah. I mean, I don't think you can have any arguments about the penalty. It was definitely a penalty. But you've got to put them away, and people, as we were saying, they're applauding the penalty, but they've got to put it in first. And
yeah, no.
I think you've got to waylay the celebrations, really.
Just let's put aside any doubts whatsoever.
I mean, he's had a tug at him first, Richard. He's got the wrong side of him, and he has brought him down. He's tripped him up. But...
And Andy Porter scored a penalty last week. He just seemed to drag that wide, didn't he?
Yeah, he didn't take a long run-up, did he? I'm not sure. There's a lot of theories about taking long run-ups, short run-ups, and I don't really think there's any golden rule, but he's hit the post and it's gone the wrong side.
Okay, thanks for the moment, Andy. Not far off a summit meeting at the Hawthorns today. West Brom against Leicester. Whoever wins that one will go second in the First Division tonight. The commentator for the first 45-minute highlights, Alan Parry.
Low in this sort of free roll between the midfield and the strikers. Parker played a brilliant ball back to him. Roberts on the far post, over his head, and it's in, yes! Leicester City take the lead. I saw them very early on in the season at Derby. They weren't quite as good that day as they've already played here. Cormack going forward for them and finding Ewan Roberts. Good effort, yes! It's 2-0. Parker helping it on to Robbins. Now Whitlow again. Roberts on the far post, he's played it in behind him, and Taylor comes in and has got a second goal for him and a third goal for Leicester City.
Well, Leicester City well on their way to their sixth away win of the season. At Boundary Park is finally poised. It's Oldham 1, Port Vale 1. Still time to have a go at the competition. About 4 minutes. Ring in on 0891405080. You've got up until the first kick of the second half, basically. First prize, £200, and five runners-up prizes as well, which I told you about later. We'll be back with the second half from Oldham very, very shortly.
OK, past the electric shop, left at the baker's, straight on past the solicitors, and the goal's right in front of you. You can't miss it, it's over there. You can't miss it.
Yellow Pages, supporters of the Granada match live.
With over 500 price cuts, the Argos Christmas booklet helps you give more for your money. Out now.
Once you've learned the secret of marinating, you just won't be able to stop.
Addiction by Fabergé. Feel good enough to eat.
I'm Stephanie Granger. I'm 43. I've used Oil of Eule since I was 17.
Beauty fluid from Oil of Eule. Living proof it works.
If you have brake problems, drive into your local QuickFit centre. Last year, QuickFit inspected and repaired more brakes than anyone else in the UK. Our highly trained brake specialists are qualified to work on virtually every car. And at QuickFit, a complete brake inspection is absolutely free. It's all part of our Brake Safe service. Brake Safe, yet another good reason for stopping at QuickFit.
Hand-pulled nectar. Mm. Emphatic toffee notes. Soft and malty at the tip of the tongue. It has a suede texture and slide.
Victoria Wine would say it's a smooth beer with a good head. Oh. Great with Match of the Day.
Oh, Match of the Day. Chestikov beating Dropinov. Queen mated King.
Victoria Wine. Connoisseurs who make sense.
In your application, you say you've ideas on how to save the company money.
Take the cost of business travel. You go first class by train to London. Enjoy car parking, reserved seats, full English breakfast.
Certainly adds up.
Not forgetting a Zone 1 tube ticket when you arrive.
But with Business Advance, you get all these extras free
for less than a first class return.
Welcome aboard.
Intercity Business Advance. Think about it.
Every year, hundreds of young men endure countless hours of deadly, tedious, mind-numbing boredom.
But for the next few weeks, Snickers offer you the chance to win one of 1,000 pairs of Adidas Predators, the football boots that give you more power, more swerve, and more control. So please, check out a Snickers bar today.
And maybe scenes like this will be a thing of the past.
The Dad's Doorstep Challenge is here in Dublin, where we're going to try and surprise someone.
Oh, I'm supposed to surprise you. This is the Dad's Doorstep Challenge. How are you?
Do you use Dad's?
I do, yes.
Yeah? And are you prepared to show the nation your whites right here?
I am, yes.
Yeah?
That's my T-shirt. I expect white,
yeah,
when I get them for Dad's.
What have you got down there?
That's chocolate cake, actually.
And will it get that out, do you think?
Oh, of course it will, yes.
Oh, you're that confident?
Oh, yes. I've great faith in Dad's.
And what about value for money?
Very good value. That's not the reason I buy it, because I've been raised on Dad's. I've always found it good for whites, so hopefully my daughters will pick it up.
Well, generation to generation have passed the Dad's Doorstep Challenge. Would you?
Second thoughts occasionally. So at Nationwide, when you open a savings account that ties your money up, you get 14 days to change your mind.
You may now be seated.
Bonnie.
Dotty.
And so does everyone else.
Bye.
Building trust with Nationwide, the building society.
Is that better? Well, it's a new corset. It'll loosen up. There you go. Off you go, son.
Yellow Pages, supporters of the Granada match live.
And welcome back to you. 1-1 it is at Boundary Park, a game which Oldham really should have had dead and buried from their point of view, Andy, but which is very much alive from Port Vale. So, I mean, you predicted 3-1 at the start.
I think my prediction's out the window now. I think it's going to be about 5-4. But, yeah, definitely. I mean, you know, they should have had the game sewn up, really, Oldham. They've had chances, but they haven't been able to get anybody on the end of them. And like you say, it's changed the game. The Mills goal has put them back in it.
Here is Oldham's version of David Fairclough, super sub David Beresford, who you saw score a tremendous goal when he came on a couple of weeks ago, Andy. Obviously a player that you know and of great potential, 19 years of age.
Exactly, yeah. I mean, he's got tremendous pace and he does know where the goal is. And I think really all he needs now is the experience to bring him on.
And it's Sean McCarthy who's gone off. Could be a result of that knock he got a little earlier.
Yes, yeah. I think he got a banger on the head, didn't he? And maybe he's got a bit of blurred vision or whatever, I don't know. But definitely I think this will help Oldham with his pace. If they can get him in, it'll cause Port Vale problems.
OK, well, you can't be too careful with head injuries. Maybe our team out there at Boundary Park can let us know a little bit more about it. John, have you got the lowdown on why McCarthy's gone off yet? Injured or tactical?
No, thank you, Elton. No word on the reasons for the substitution as yet, but the suspicion, obviously, is that McCarthy, with that head wound in the first half, has maybe got a spot of concussion. We shall find out for you, Elton. Rest assured. So we're underway. The substitute, by the way, is David Beresford, who's only 18. There was a huge roar that greeted the announcement of his arrival on the pitch. Guppy with this free kick. Back wide. McCarthy hustling for it on the edge of the area. And away by Richardson. There's Richardson again, and then chested on by Wilkinson. And this flying move brings in Beresford for the first time. This is why the fans like him. He's quick. He crosses a good ball in as well towards Gunnar Haller, who has switched from right to left because of the introduction of Beresford. Naylor. And they've won the ball back again already, but that's a poorly delivered cross this time. Well, Mike Sadler's on the touchline for us. Mike, what is the news about the substitution?
Simply precautionary, John. They wanted just to double-check on Sean McCarthy. Nothing serious, but they felt that as he was feeling a little bit queasy, it was wiser to take him out of the action at this point.
Thank you. That brings everybody up to speed, so to speak. 1-1 the scoreline. Frenetic first half in many ways. And there, Guppy fails to control the ball, and that sets Beresford on his way again. Forward by Snowden, and it was missed by Haller, but fortuitously, because it's opened the way for Wilkinson, who might still get a shot in. No, he doesn't at the end. I don't think he quite believed the position he was in.
Well, he couldn't. He could have hit it earlier on a couple of occasions, but he hung on and he hung on. Port Vale did their best to let him get it in, and in the end, somebody just flicked it away from him.
That may be one of those, Jim, where Paul Wilkinson's not quite as sharp as he would like to be because he's not had much first-team action. He's there again, and he heads it forward. It's Dean Glover's clearance straight to Richardson. Snowden, Haller's calling for it. There is Wilkinson, in for Haller here. Oh, brilliant save by Musselwhite. Gunnar Haller cannot believe that he hasn't restored Oldham's lead.
Well, you would have thought those two have been playing together the whole game. Gunnar Haller has gone up front after Sean McCarthy went off. David Beresford is now on the right side. And when the ball came in from Snowden here, great header down. And Haller was so unlucky. Marvellous save from Musselwhite.
That is a top draw save. And they've still got chances here. Redmond heads in. And it's just a corkscrew header from Haller that goes over the top of the Port Vale goal.
Well, it looks extremely promising since that change. Now Gunnar Haller already in the thick of it. Twice we've seen him involved there. The second time, well, again, it was a difficult one. Had to try and turn round, try and keep the header down. Couldn't.
Gunnar Haller, whose only goal this season in the league, came at Norwich City. He had a 2-1 defeat, so he's due one here at Boundary Park. Usually gets a few in a season. Talbot. Put his own full-back hill under a little bit of pressure there, but he showed good control. Port Vale don't seem to be too sure of themselves back there again. Richardson now for Oldham, and Wilkinson makes the run, but offside is given. But Gunnar Haller, it's utility always sounds a derogatory term in many ways to me, but he is a utility player because he can play fullback, wing, centre forward,
well,
anything.
Well, he could fit in anywhere, and again, this is the chance. Wilkinson with the header down. Hall has done everything you could ask of him. He's kept the shot down, and Musselwhite, marvellous reflex save.
The words of my co-commentator, Jim Beglin, who will be nominating today's man of the match. There's Tony Naylor with a spinning shot which had no sting in it. Slip for John McCarthy. He's a cheerful player though, he won't complain about that. Haller almost caught there by Griffiths. Spins away for Brennan, but he can't control it. Oh, and well, McCarthy didn't look offside, but the linesman thought he was. And a shake of the head from the former York City player, and a smile from Mr. Oldham here in Oldham tells us that it was.
Well, linesman was only a couple of yards from McCarthy. Couldn't miss it.
Oh, Glover's got under that. Wilkinson, a free header. Couldn't find Haller. But what is going on in that Port Vale defence? I couldn't believe the amount of space there Wilkinson had for that header.
Well, it took an eternity to come down, and absolutely no Port Vale player came forward to challenge Wilkinson. I think, again, he's tried to just flick it for Gunnar Haller. Couldn't quite get him in this time. And got involved in a little tussle with Andy Porter. But referee sorted it out.
Can afford to smile now, can't he? Snowden. Well, he's delivered better passes than that one. Offside again. Mills, who scored that spectacular first half goal. And he seems to have a habit of scoring televised goals. I remember the first one he ever got, which was for Wolves at Ipswich in an FA Cup tie.
He scored a beauty in the Granada match live as well last season, John, for Derby at the baseball ground. The winner against Bolton. Must have been about 30 yards right into the top corner.
Well, Port Vale would settle for a repeat. And here they come forward with Guppy. Just too much height on that for a little Naylor, who's only about 5 feet five. Too much height on that ball for Wilkinson to cope with as well. Talbot trying to angle it in between fullback Makin and the goalkeeper, but it didn't come off. The referee's got good hearing because the fans were shouting, "Come on, ref!" beneath me there, thinking there should have been a free kick, and he made a little gesture to say, "Listen, I know what I'm doing. You watch the match, I'll officiate it." Brennan, good ball. Haller on the chase up against Griffiths. Still Haller, Wilkinson in the middle, but Musselwhite with an easy catch and an easy hurdle as well for Dean Glover over his stranded keeper.
Well, he's certainly a mobile player, Haller. He's putting himself about again, made the run down the left that time. Dragged Griffiths, the centre-back, out with him. But again, couldn't pull it back enough. Try and get another Oldham player in.
He's a consistent player, Gunnar Haller, as well. Since he always has been since he came here from Norway.
He's a real trier, John, isn't he? He's always enthusiastic, no matter what position he's playing in, and he'll give everything a go.
Porter now. Here's Fleming up against Naylor, and he's a good deal taller than Naylor. There's Fleming again with a covering header. Well, play seemed to stand still there, and that has afforded Naylor the opportunity to come forward. Talbot, there's shooting space for him there, which he didn't take. Haller. Haller's offside now.
Well, he just went a touch too early, but again, good understanding between Haller and Wilkinson. Seemed to know each other's game quite well. Haller with the control, Wilkinson flicking it through, but he just went a touch too early.
There's one here to chase, Makin's header, and it's going to come back for McCarthy. And this time he tanked. Oh, it was a close one, that, for Lee Mills. On to the end of McCarthy's first time cross.
Well, it was hard for Steve Redmond to do anything about it because McCarthy's cross was right onto Mills' head. Got in there first. Really, he should have kept that down a little bit better than he did.
Brennan had a chance here to knock one in, but it wasn't a dangerous enough ball. Snowden clips it up here for Haller. A cushioned header. Brennan's pass went astray. And now Naylor, the goalkeeper at this end, Gerrard, off his line in good time. Trying to get in behind Makin and Redmond. Fleming. Richardson. Hustled out of it by Porter. And Porter must be desperate for Port Vale to get another goal, having missed a penalty. Probably the best opening. Wilkinson gets a shot in here.
Well, he did well initially, Wilkinson, because I don't think he could have been expecting Richard Grayton to pull it back there. Got in front of the defender, but again, the defender did well enough to make it difficult to get a clean hit in.
McCarthy gets in a header. And McCarthy again, he's desperately trying to get involved in this game, John McCarthy. He's had to come in field to do that. Oh, that's a giveaway. Bad ball from Talbot. Now it's Beresford. Oldham start from the back with Fleming. Wilkinson gets the flick through. Here's Haller into the area. And it'll come back for Beresford. And he was fouled there, was Beresford. A little nudge from Tankard, which was well spotted by the linesman on that far side.
Yeah, he's just barged into his back. I think Tankard is obviously worried because Beresford took him on. But the first run in the second half, got past him with ease. He doesn't want to let it happen again.
Oldham have four men in the middle to try and meet this. Port Vale are about, well, everybody's back now. They're all back there. So Port Vale have to defend against this free kick, and it's well driven in by Ian Snuddin. It took a deflection, and that will be a corner. He'd like a goal. It's been a long time since his last one. It was for Everton against Wimbledon 2.5 years ago.
Andy Porter did well here. Short free kick. Porter was the one closed him down. He just got the touch to take it over.
The Oldham fans baying for another goal. Richardson, Musselwhite, Graham, and it's bubbling around all over. Haller can't get his head to it, and Tankard clears. Wilkinson, a little knock down for Beresford. Well, the fans love him, and you can see why, because he is very quick, isn't he? And Graham Sharp's got great hopes for this youngster.
Well, he doesn't hang about. If he's given a chance to run, if the fullback sits off him, he'll get turned, and he's very positive with it. Goes right for it. But it's a good little spell from Oldham now, having the better of the possession. They just can't get it to drop for them in the Port Vale box.
Oh, that was a shove in the back. Glover on Wilkinson, free kick.
Can't believe he's even protesting on that one. It was a clear push in the back, and yet he still says, what for, ref?
Well, defenders tend to be like that, Duke. It's already taken, and Snowden's got the chance to play one across here. Wilkinson coming for it! And the glided header goes wide, but Wilkinson knows he might well have done better and had a second goal.
Well, the crosses from here to Snowden are getting better and better. Again, he's looked up, seen Paul Wilkinson, picked him out. And again, John, he should have done better there. I think he was up slightly early, but he got to it. Hands went straight on the head. He knows he should have actually got that on target. In between the two Port Vale defenders, there he is up there, possibly slightly early. He's on the way down by the time he touches it and flashes it wide.
Oldham's throw. Still plenty of time left for either of these sides to win. Remember, if Oldham do, they'll go up six places, up to seventh in the table. They'll climb above Ipswich, Grimsby, Charlton, Huddersfield, Norwich and Barnsley, depending on Charlton's result against Sunderland today. Two other games, West Bromwich Albion, Leicester and Charlton, Sunderland this afternoon. Oh, and this goalkeeper's under pressure. Gerrard booked it away with Naylor breathing down him.
Yeah, he'd seen him all along when he controlled it. I think one or two people felt he hadn't, but he knew he was there, released it quickly.
It's here with Talbot now. And a very lazy clip. Glover, it was rather a short ball, but Tankard has hoofed it forward. Guppy. Again, we were saying in the first half that Guppy and McCarthy hadn't really got into this game as they would like, but here the two of them combine, and that was McCarthy's work, which puts some pressure on Oldham. Well, they relieve their lines, and here goes Snowden again. Pahala turns his man well, and then slipped as he was critically trying to play the ball through to Wilkins. Down the line is McCarthy again, who enjoys taking on defenders, but straight onto Redmond's head that time. Mills. Hill. Now McCarthy again. And he might go a long way here, but for the fact that Redmond stood in his way. McCarthy's looked much more positive in this second half, though, keen to get into the match.
Well, I think John Rudge will have told both his wingers to work a little bit harder. They won't just come to you all the time. Sometimes you've got to go looking for it. And they're certainly trying to do that in the second half. But the final ball all the time is letting Port Vale down.
Here goes Talbot, though, and he's made some spirited runs, and he's made another one here. Keeps getting into the area. And then that might stay in play. It does. Hooked back by Naylor. And this is what the crowd want to see. Beresford in full flight. And away he goes. And he'll take them on, that is for sure. And on he goes. Can he get past Tankard? No, he's run the ball out. Well, he just ran out of space there.
Well, he did. He needed help, but to be honest, he was so fast for all his teammates that nobody could get in support. Lee Richardson was the one closest. He just couldn't keep up with him.
There's an angled ball up here for Mills, and he is onside. He's confronted by Snowden. That's well done. He knows Guppy was there and can deliver a decent cross, and that he does, and it's taken nicely by Gerrard. Oh, touched back by Glover. Russell White, calm enough. Mike, anything happening down on the touchline?
Well, John, the more eagle-eyed of the viewers may notice that poor Russell White in the Vale goes actually swapped his jersey. He's now wearing number 13, Arjen van Houston's jersey. Maybe he thinks it'll bring a bit of luck on the bench. It seems to be a mystery. I'll bring you any update on the mystery of the swap shirt as soon as I get it.
Oh, he's probably hoping it's not going to be an unlucky number 13. Muslawaita was beaten once in the first half. He certainly didn't dirty his sweater. Perhaps it's a superstitious thing, likes to wear two different jerseys during a game.
I would have thought the opposite, John. It's bringing him a bit of luck, because must remember earlier in the second half he pulled off a fantastic save from Gunnar Haller.
Hill knocks one long. And the keeper just gets his hands on it. Gerrard, that was enough to release Snowden. I'm sure Snowden said to Beresford, go on, get up there, give it a go. Wilkinson They seem to be pulled by Griffiths, and Wilkinson certainly complains, but the action switches straight away to the other end, and Redmond's header. And Redmond has certainly had an impressive return to the side today.
Redmond's done very well. I mean, we commented in the first half, he's got the experience, he's got the cool head in tight situations when the pressure is on. And again, he showed it there, Naylor closing him down, header back to the goalkeeper.
Guppy. Talbot again is the one making a driving run through midfield, but it was a poorly laid pass that time.
Well, that's the problem now. McCarthy's coming inside, trying to get on the ball more, and any time it is sprayed out wide, it's just over his head.
Redmond, a man who's always had leadership qualities, I've felt. He'll have some more defending to do now, because Naylor is here and can knock a decent ball over the top for Mills. Guppy's behind Snowden. Here's Guppy now, they're two in the middle. Guppy's ball in, and they seem to get in each other's way there, McCarthy and Naylor.
Well, what a good chance it was. Tony Naylor was the one that got in on it. Great ball in again. Tony Naylor just got that one wrong. He's taken it with his right. He probably would have been better off just trying to flick it with his left. Good ball in across the six-yard box from Guppy. Hard for defenders to deal with. And there you see it. Tried to just play it in with his right. Possibly would have been better just trying to flick it with his left.
Naylor without a goal since last April in a match at Reading, a 3-3 draw. But Port Vale have suddenly found some belief in themselves again. John Rudge obviously alarmed at the team's position at the foot of the table, but still has the belief in his players. One of the problems Port Vale have is that they've only got a very small squad. Naylor's offside. And Gerrard, that's certainly the longest clearance I've seen in a long time.
He didn't mess about there, he wasn't taking any chances.
Oh, word, that nearly went out the ground. They'd have enjoyed that a bit, the water sheddings, I think. And a free kick taken by Fleming. And Craig Fleming back in the side today is a bit of a worried lad, because his wife Nicola is expecting their second child, and it's due probably this afternoon. So he'd like a victory to celebrate. Wilkinson, oh, and if he just controlled that, there might have been a chance for Brennan.
Well, he was trying the shot. Mark Brennan wasn't expecting it. And when it did actually come into him, Wilkinson as well holds it up, gets turned and comes through. It's a bit hard for him to try and control, he wasn't expecting it.
Naylor is dispossessed making, Mills can make himself a hero here. It's a good tackle by Fleming. Well, still chances appearing at both ends. Still 1-1. Just as it was last week at Norwich and the week before at Stoke on Granada. Let's see if anybody's going to steal a winner in this game. Guppy with a corner for Port Vale. Remember, they've won away from home twice this season, and McCarthy can drill one through. Could have gone anywhere. Guppy. And between them, the two Oldham men managed to win the ball. Andy Hill storms forward. Guppy, he's onside. Three in the middle, calling for the ball. It's deep for Mills. There's the header, and he was pushing. And knows he doesn't complain about that one.
No, he knows. He's had a moan or two at the referee earlier in the game. Guppy picks it up again. He's got lots of time to look up, try and pick out Lee Mills. That's who he's aiming for. But little Ian Snowden did well to grapple away, and it was a push in the back on the Oldham fullback.
Lee Mills with that fifth goal of the season. Dropped last week. He's, in fact, all his goals have been scored away from home. There's a curious fact for you. Five of them all away from Port Vale.
Well, whatever John Rogers said to him at half-time, it's working wonders, because he's putting himself about in this second half and causing Oldham problems.
Brennan. Important win there by Tankard, with Beresford there alongside him. Snowden, who's played in one or two good crosses, and Wilkinson comes, but so does Musselwhite, our number 13 goalkeeper. McCarthy. Naylor, there's a bit of space on the left for Guppy, he can really attack from here. Guppy gets past Snowden, there are plenty of bodies in the middle, it's coming out for Mills, and just clips off the top of the bar. And a couple of feet further on, and I think Mills would have scored. As it turned out, Guppy almost got the ball in.
Well, he's trying to cross this again, but sometimes they can go in. He's looking up, Lee Mills has taken up a position on the far post, Gerrard's on his near post, and that almost just dropped below.
Everybody was looking to Mills. Guppy was nearly a scorer himself. Mills was offside here. Chance just to pop down to the touchline again, Mike.
I think you'll find shortly, John, that Gunnar Haller has switched to the right-hand side. Message pass via Snowden now to David Beresford to link up with Wilkinson down the centre. Haller will play on the right.
And here is Beresford into that area. And free kick given. Well, the manager, Graham Sharp, obviously thinking throughout this match. That's what a manager's got to do. He can't just sit there and watch the entertainment. He's got to be thinking all the time.
Well, I think what he's hoping by putting David Beresford up there alongside Paul Wilkinson is that if Wilkinson can't get the flick on, Beresford's so sharp, he'll react a little bit quicker and try and get that goal they so badly need now.
Certainly a very hard one to predict this, because Port Vale have opened up Oldham two or three times recently. And to be fair to Port Vale, they may have their problems at home, but they've scored in all their last eight games this season, so they're finding the net quite regularly. And they've got a few ideas going forward. Their wins came at Stoke and Huddersfield. And here's Naylor now inside the area. It didn't fall for him. Now we've just seen how far Gerrard can boot this ball. It's going to come back all the way to him again. Have another go. Measures it for Beresford. Then it's Wilkinson trying to get in. Richardson. Graham. Richardson again. And it's a feeble effort in the end. Richardson, we've not seen a lot of in the second half, to be fair.
Well, that was lovely pass and move football from Oldham. Difficult to pick up the runner, and when it eventually found its way to Richardson, we've seen it so many times this afternoon, when they get in that position, they're not really connecting. And they're not troubling the keepers as they should be.
No beef in it at all, was there? Free kick at the other end. But the officials have had a pretty easy afternoon from the players. Just the one booking. It's got through to Beresford. Brought out by Glover. Mills on the charge here with Fleming. Has a corner out of this. It's a muscular game. And there's a bit of shoving and pushing goes on. But the referees know that. And he allowed that. And it's a corner for Port Vale.
Well, Mills has taken so much pressure off his defence. I mean, his runs into the corners, they can play it long. We've got a corner now.
And up goes Griffiths, all 6 foot four of him, to the near post. Could look for a flick on. Easy enough for Gerrard, though. A man who kept 12 clean sheets in 17 appearances. Richardson, forward towards Beresford. Well, again, we've said it so many times this season, draws are really no good for teams. They'd much rather win one and lose one than draw two games nowadays. You're not paid to be consistent at times. Port Vale certainly need more. They've only got 11 points so far this season. Up goes Graham to supplement Wilkinson in attack for this corner kick to come in from Richardson, the former Halifax player. And Wilkinson was going for it. Easily belted away by McCarthy, though. What's more, he found his own man in there, Naylor. And they're breaking quickly here. Port Vale, four in a row there. Guppy's the man on the ball, and he's just hit the bar with one teasing effort. But that was an easy block. Port Vale really didn't utilise what they had there. And Wilkinson and Griffiths go down in a heap, and a free kick's going to be given against Wilkinson.
Yeah, you can't complain with that one. Ball was played over the top. Wilkinson gives chase. Griffiths is there in front. Wilkinson just rugby tackles him, pulls him back.
Yes, I think he'd actually lost his footing and he just grabbed at the defender to steady himself. But it was a foul. Now then, what's going to happen here? Wilkinson tussling for the ball. Sprays it out for Haller, whose first job is to keep it in. He does that well. And they're all waiting in here, and it has to be put to safety by Hill. Andy Hill, the former Bury and Manchester City defender, is having a good run in the team. He's had so many injury problems in recent seasons. Nice for him to have a good run. Oldham's second corner in 2 minutes. The first one produced nothing, and this one produces nothing.
Well, the corners from both sides in the last couple of minutes haven't been good. They've played them up in the air, sat them up, made it easy for the goalkeepers to come and collect, and they're only too happy to do it.
Tankard's infield ball, headed on by Graham, but headed in the wrong direction. And a cool clearance from Fleming when it was most needed. And there's Fleming again with another one. Well, the tackle on Brennan was effective and Guppy's away for Port Vale. The ball in, here's Naylor! And a fabulous save, and let it close in now. Well, it's Mills who spins on it. We've had excellent saves at both ends of the field from Musselwhite, and that one from Gerrard, who pushed Naylor's header up into the air. It could still have gone in.
That's magnificent goalkeeping again. The hesitancy came from Steve Redman. He thought his goalkeeper was going to come. He didn't. Naylor got the header in, and all credit to Paul Gerrard. Magnificent goalkeeping.
Fast and furious, but we haven't yet had another goal to go with those early ones. We have now. No, kicked off the line by Redman. And they cannot believe that they haven't scored there, Port Vale, twice.
Well, Griffiths was the one in there challenging the goalkeeper, and Gerrard, I think, felt he was impeded. It didn't look it. When it felt that E. Mills got it on target, Steve Redman, he's had a good game this afternoon, back there again, getting it away.
The corner short, McCarthy to Guppy. Can Port Vale snatch it? No, there's that man Gerrard again. It was a critical save that Gerrard made. And even then, it needed the cool head of Redmond and the good positional play to deny Lee Mills a goal. McCarthy. Well, it's offside here. It's been lively entertainment, whether you're in the ground here or sitting in your armchair at home. And I hope you've enjoyed the match. It's one apiece and perfectly poised. Can finish anyway. Haller's header. Goal kick.
Well, the football trying to get the ball into the box may not be too elegant today, John, but they're getting it there. We're seeing lots of incident. We can't complain about the excitement from time to time.
Over 12 minutes left here at Boundary Park for either of these sides to settle it on the day. They both won their home matches last season. 3-2 here it was for Oldham, 3-1 to Port Vale at Vale Park. When Naylor was among the scorers, and I think he thought he was a scorer a couple of minutes ago.
Yeah, I think all he thought he had to do was just get his head on it. The pace was on the cross, got it on target. He was the last one expecting Gerrard to pull off such a miraculous save.
It's the sort of thing that happens when you're short of a goal, and Naylor's not got one this season, albeit he's not started that many games. Well, both sides have the inclination to win this one, and they've shown that they can create the opportunity. It's by no means guaranteed it's going to end at one apiece, so stay with us till the end of this one.
Well, they both want the 3 points, John. Port Vale, for obvious reasons, on the bottom, only 11 points so far this season, and well, Oldham have a great incentive too. I mean, they can jump all those places. You've said that before.
In a very even division, there doesn't look to be an outstanding side in there. And if you do leap 6 places, all of a sudden it puts you right back in the hunt. We're only about a quarter of the way through the season. Here's Macon, You tend to forget that after so many matches. There's a long way to go. Wilkinson's done well there, directed it down for Beresford. Now he can make an impact. Coming up on the right is Snowden. Haller's calling for it round about this penalty spot. It's just beyond him. Oh, McCarthy did a good tracking job there, otherwise Beresford might have been in. Looks as though Beresford favours a long throw in here, despite his lack of inches. And there it is for Wilkinson. Haller still in play, still in play, and Musselwhite able to bring it down under the challenge of Richardson. Yes, I think Mr. Musselwhite said the ball was out there.
I think he's actually complaining to his defender, Dean Glover. He shouldn't have allowed the cross to come in the first place.
Forward from Snowden. Down from Wilkinson. That's good play. They've just got to make sure they stay onside here. But Haller's held it up well to bring Snowden into it again. And he's driven cross. Beresford will have a go. And it comes back off Griffiths. And a rather clumsy attempt at a clearance by Talbot. He finally effects it. Makin wants to do McCarthy on the outside, swings the ball in, and no problems for Paul Musselwhite.
No, he's been busy, but he's handled everything with ease. Anything that's come in there, he's dominated like a good goalkeeper should. And again, he was alive, expecting the cross to come in from Makin, anticipating where it's going to end up, telling his defender to leave it be, and he gathered again.
Redmond was strong again there. Beat his man away. Hill. Oof, and Redmond catches Naylor here. He was a little overstrong that time.
Well, you don't have to put your foot very high to catch Tony Naylor. He's only a small guy, but the referee was right to penalise Steve Redmond for that one. It was a little bit reckless. He just lunged out. Certainly a ball you could head. You just caught Naylor on the back of the head. A little nasty.
Size 9.5 on the back of your neck. No matter how big you are, you feel that, don't you? Anyway, it could have been worse. And the referee sensibly had a check and said, play on, we're okay. And it's lifted in there towards Mills. Back here for Talbot, who goes for the spectacular and doesn't quite make it.
That's always a good position to pick up for an attacking midfielder on the edge of the box. You likely pick up the pieces. He did then. Poor attempt.
McCarthy forward. Naylor tries to get in, and it's Redmond who slides it back. Graham's flicked through. Wilkinson's touch, and now Brennan. Too far. Guppy. Nicely taken down by Hill, but he has to check before feeding McCarthy. Lobbed in for Naylor. Played the ball around convincingly here, and Naylor's still going as well. Finally beaten away by Makin. The quality of the passing not too impressive there. And again, Naylor finds himself one-on-one against Redmond, and again Redmond wins.
Yeah, the Oldham fans a little frustrated there. Richard Graham tried to play the ball out of the fence. Could have picked out another couple of blue shirts around him, but he just lumped the ball forward and gave it away.
Well, I wonder how much Port Vale are going to miss that penalty. The miss by Andy Porter in the first half, so critical, and I really feel they are ruining that missed opportunity. Port Vale could have been still 2-1 ahead at this stage, but 6 minutes left, it's still one apiece. He got one of the goals for his manager, who's still as vocal as ever. Given Oldham's way here. Oldham have a chance here, and this time the physio is going to be required. Port Vale's Glover down on his haunches, but he's a tough cookie, this fella. Takes a lot to get rid of him, especially at this stage of a match where he knows there's so little time left. And the physio, Rick Carter, just checking Mr. Glover's health, and he's all right. He won't be if Oldham score from this. Brennan and Richardson. Maybe poised for glory, who knows? Well, that wall looks a good 10 yards to me. And the referee has measured it. And Richardson, I could see the idea of that. He tried to slide it through to Snuddin. It didn't come off, and the crowd are booing, but at least it was imaginative. Now then, Beresford, what can he do? Floats the ball in, Wilkinson gets up well. Oh, handball! Of all people, it's Porter, the captain. The man who missed the penalty in the first half now gives the opponents the opportunity to win the game from the penalty spot.
He knows it, John. He knows he's handled it. Wilkinson does so well on the far post to get up there. The ball bounces away, it comes off his tie, and he puts his arm out to stop the ball getting past him. Porter's handled that.
And there's a bit of bother over there as well, because the linesman has called the referee's attention to something that's been said. And it's a red card. The protest has led to the dismissal of Steve Guppy. He obviously said something to the linesman amid all the mayhem. And it looks as though Paul Wilkinson's going to take this on his debut. What a hero he can become if it is him. He's coming at a funny angle if it is him. It could be Richardson. Well, they're keeping the waiting. It's Richardson. And here he is to win the match, maybe, for Oldham. They have the lead back. Richardson scores. Graham Sharp settles back alongside Colin Harvey, a much happier man. And maybe Port Vale have surrendered a game they could have won.
Well, it was a good penalty from Lee Richardson. He's kept a cool head. He knew he had to put it in. Oldham wanted 3 points badly. Sent the goalkeeper the wrong way. Picked a spot. Side-footed very firmly. Oldham 2-1 up.
Oldham's first successful penalty kick of the season, and it's Lee Richardson who gets it, his fourth goal of the season, his third in the last four games. And Port Vale's response now is to bring on Ian Bogie, with Dean Glover, the injured party, going off. But what an afternoon for the captain. Porter misses a penalty in the first half, gives one away in the second, and Port Vale could well lose the game as a result.
Well, he won't want to remember this one in a hurry. Tried to drive the penalty in the first half, just pulled it a little bit off the post and wide, and it was clearly a handball. He can have no complaints, and Guppy was stupid in whatever he said to the linesman. There's nothing you can do once the decision is given, and it was obviously a bad case of dissent. That's why he went off. Lee Richardson did very well to keep his head, though.
Got another spring in the step of Oldham, and Haller wants to take the throw in quickly, but he can't because it's Port Vale's. What an important win this could be for Oldham Athletic. It's booted high over the halfway line, and Port Vale have no alternative now but to fling everything into the bid for a second equaliser. They've got one. And there, Redmond with the header. Good clearance from him. And then Wilkinson can't win it. Port Vale do. And straight out of play. Gives Jim Medlin time to tell us who the man of the match is today.
Well, it's been close, John. Nobody's really stood out. Nobody's had an outstanding game. But I think probably the best player on the pitch has been Oldham Steve Redmond at the back. Anytime Port Vale have had an extended spell of pressure in the second half, he's the one that's mainly prevented him getting a lead in this game, and he's done superbly well at the back all afternoon for Oldham.
He's revealed his usual leadership qualities, and that's been needed today. Port Vale have certainly had their chances to win this one, and they'll look back at it afterwards and say, you know, why didn't we do this, why didn't we do that, instead of which they're having to defend again they're in arrears, and more valuable points seem to be slipping away for them. Haller. Foul. Snowden. No point in rushing anything now for Oldham. They can afford to keep the ball tight in that corner. The fans are exhorting them, imploring them to do a bit more in attack. Here's Beresford. Could have got a third, but no, the whistle has already gone. Free kick. He has got a goal, Beresford, in his infant career. He scored the winner in the last home game against Reading. That's why he's such a favourite with the fans here. They remember that. Well, 90 minutes up, but it's a little bit of time to be added on. Wilkinson gets a good touch on. And I think Graham Sharp will be reasonably pleased with Paul Wilkinson. Would like to make his move here permanent, I'm sure, having not been in the Middlesbrough first team. Naylor, oh, he nearly got a ball through there to Mills. Port Vale aren't out of it yet. Bogey, McCarthy, knocks it across, oh, it's there, it's 2-2, Mills has surely snatched a point for Port Vale with his second goal. Bill Dearden and John Rudge off their seats. Oldham are caught cold by Lee Mills' second goal of the game.
Well, they just got everybody back. They were just trying to keep them out. Nobody closed down McCarthy, allowed him to get it in. Just the barest of touches from Lee Mills, flicks it into the corner. Oh, what a disaster from Graham Sharp and his men there. Again, somebody should have been looking to get tighter on McCarthy. Gave him all the time in the world to cross it in. Might have even come off Mills' shoulder. Doesn't matter, it's inside that post and it looks as if they've got a point out of it.
Well, that is all that matters, and Lee Mills, for the first time as a Port Vale player, has scored two in a game. And it's a dramatic finish we've got here to the game at Boundary Park, because Mr. Richards is going to blow that final whistle, I would think, any minute. It seems certain when Porter conceded that penalty that Richardson had won the game for Oldham Athletic. But Mills, with his second goal, has surely won Port Vale a point, and now trouble between Naylor and Snowden. Probably a little frustration on the part of the Oldham captain there, who went in much too hard. And I think he's going to get a booking, certainly, for that.
Well, the referee didn't seem as if he was going to take any action once the tackle went in, but it was when they got involved in a little bit of pushing and shoving that the referee thought Snowden was a little too heavy-handed. But Snowden, he did go in hard in the challenge, but initially he appeared to play the ball. Naylor picks it up on the edge, little slip, and as he tries to pick himself up, there he comes. He comes through, seems to play the ball, he takes the player as well. We've seen worse tackles.
Yes, I think, as you said, Jim, it was what happened immediately after that, wasn't it? The fact they squared up to one another without making contact, really.
Yeah, Snowden appeared to grab Naylor around the neck, and referee didn't like that.
And the referee points to the dressing rooms. The 2-2 draw doesn't really do either side any good, but Lee Mills, very much the hero of the afternoon for Port Vale. He scored two goals, one of outstanding quality in the first half, and a late header after Nick Richardson's penalty seemed to have won the day for Oldham Athletic. Their other goal coming from home debut man Paul Wilkinson. Raw entertainment for the fans to enjoy. And at the end of the day, it's a point apiece here for Oldham Athletic and for Port Vale. So we can hear now from Port Vale manager John Rudge.
John Rudge, your response to a dramatic game of football?
Well, I mean, it's what we deserved. We've had numerous chances really to go in front, missed a penalty, and lo and behold, I thought we were going to throw it away by giving a penalty away. But the lads have worked very hard to get that point, and let's hope that might be a bit of a platform to go and win at home. We made a lot of chances there, and we could have won the match.
John Rudge, thanks very much indeed.
Well, Port Vale's knack of nicking points away from home really is quite uncanny, isn't it? We'll have a reaction from Andy Ritchie and so much more to come on the Granada Match Live after the break.
Yes! Whoopee! It's a boy! It's a boy! Let's go out and buy him a train set, eh?
Yellow Pages, supporters of the Granada Match Live.
It's one of the most eagerly awaited action films this year.
God help you if you're wrong.
If I'm wrong, then we're at war.
God help us all.
Crimson Tide.
Hey, you, where are you bound? If I love forever fresh, forever young, forever...
Old Spice, forever fresh, forever young.
Life has a habit of presenting us with appealing alternatives. It's not always so easy to make the right decision. Fortunately, when it comes to choosing a mobile phone, here's one you can be sure of.
Hello?
Nokia. Because nothing connects quite like it. Nokia. Connecting people.
They're suggesting with all this fibre rubbish, pot noodle is some sort of faffy food. So, to see if people who like faffy food like pot noodle, we've come to a leisure centre. Let's go, come on.
How do, gentlemen? Just come to see if you'd like some delicious pot noodle. What are you doing?
We're trying to play a game here.
It's too gorgeous for a...
sauna.
Yeah, let's have a go in here.
Oh, he's having a barbecue in here.
Do you want a bit of pot noodle, man?
Oh, forget it, you'll never find his mouth.
Right. Do you want some pot noodle? Sorry?
Please leave.
I'm performing an experiment.
So, proof that pot noodle is not faffy food.
Gorgeous.
Don't ever go out without Sympatex, the invisible high-performance membrane built into clothes to come between you and the elements with maximum protection. Waterproof, breathable, windproof. So, whatever the weather, you're safe. Sympatex. Look for the blue triangle.
Clean as a whistle, sir.
Let me be the judge of that, Buff. It's not every day that MI7 lands a fish as big as this. Suffice to say, I should be welcoming him to the West.
Sort that out, please.
Oh, you use Barclay card.
I said fix the lavatory, Boff, not book tickets for the opera.
No, sir, Barclay card assist. They'll send an approved plumber round.
Oh, yes. A week next Tuesday. I don't know, the things I have to do for my country.
Mr. Ruth.
He's here, sir.
Scarcely worth your coming, really. There's just a bit of finishing off to do.
But, sir...
Go on, get on with it. Barclay card. Didn't look much like a plumber to me.
Mr. Boff?
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm just busy as communication for me.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, they definitely got a couple of slates loose. So have I walking around dressed like this.
Yellow Pages, supporters of the Granada Match Live.
Welcome back. Andy Ritchie's been with us throughout the afternoon. You got the correct number of goals, but not quite the balance, right?
Not quite the balance, no, but no shortage of incidents.
No, there was plenty of them, and I think one of the most outstanding before we hit the goals and the drama late on was Musselwhite's save from Gunnar Haller, your old teammate.
Yeah, I mean, super ball in. A lovely header down by Wilkinson, and Gunnar's really done well to get a great shot on it, but what a reaction save, super save.
I mean, it's uncanny how goalkeepers just do react so quickly, like lightning, isn't it?
It's what they're paid for, isn't it? But I'm sure they work on things like that in training. I'm not sure whether Port Vale have got a goalkeeping coach. I'm sure they have, but that's what they work on, reactions and getting up and down and quick around the six-yard box.
Yeah, obviously the drama really exploded sort of late on when Oldham took the lead by 2-1 with a penalty kick. I don't think there was much doubt about it, was there?
I don't think so, and I think probably Steve Guffey will be a bit disappointed when he sees the replay. It's bounced up high and he's sort of got his knee on it and he knows it's not going and he has stuck his arm out. It's a fair decision, it's a penalty.
And Andy Porter, of course, had conceded the penalty. Missed one in the first half of Port Vale, given the lesson of how to tuck them away by Lee Richardson.
Well, Lee's a cool customer anyway. He's nothing fazes him. And I had no qualms that he would put it away. And he's done it well.
Do you think, I mean, had it finished 2-1, that Port Vale would have felt a bit hard done by?
A little bit aggrieved, I think, yes. I mean, they've had the chances second half. There was another great save from Paul Gerrard. And I think they would have been a bit disappointed had they gone home being beaten 2-1.
We still haven't quite worked out how they managed to acquire these points away from home, because it wasn't as if they sort of played defensively and then attack, is it?
No, I mean, they've rode the luck a little bit as well today.
But it was a super nick there, wasn't it, by Lee Mills, his second of the game.
He's got,
I think Jim was right, it did come off his shoulder, didn't it, Andy?
I think it did, yeah. But, I mean, strikers union.
Yeah, it doesn't matter what it comes off. Another look at it.
It's a great ball in. It's a difficult ball to defend, and he's nipped in front of Craig Fleming there, and he's got a great touch onto it.
Okay, well, thanks, Andy. We'll talk again later. Just to confirm, that point does take Port Vale off the bottom of the First Division. Still plenty more to come on the Granada Match Live. Join us again.
But you need new boots. Tread's illegal on the left one. New tracking's out and all.
Yellow Pages, supporters of the Granada Match Live.
Everyone's after James Bond, and the Daily Mirror's got him. Play GoldenEye Lottery and make a killing, only with the Daily Mirror, tomorrow.
It's called 241 Pizza because you get two delicious pizzas for one low price. Call 0990-241-241 and get two pizzas for one low price.
The Bosch wallpaper stripper puts technology at your fingertips. It allows you to strip away old wallpaper simply, quickly, cleanly, and with total safety. Bosch. Excellence comes as standard.
Dragon.
Dragons? Dragon no. Dragon no.
The DeLonghi Dragon portable oil-filled radiator. It heats the room faster than any other oil-filled radiator, and it comes with a 5-year guarantee. The DeLonghi Dragon. Extraordinary.
Within 2 years, we'd double turnover.
For a small company, we've done well.
I was concerned that Ren would lose contact with the customer.
If the client isn't satisfied, we'll refund the first 3 months' service fees.
We now feel extremely confident. We've got great confidence in Alex Laurie.
We work in partnership with the client.
The sales link financing has enabled us to concentrate on putting our energies in the right direction.
I can put my mind to selling instead of chasing invoices.
That's our goal, to be the world's leading supplier of coffee mugs.
0800 55 0022.
In your application, you say you've ideas on how to save the company money.
Take the cost of business travel. You go first class by train to London. Enjoy car parking, reserved seats, full English breakfast.
Certainly adds up.
Not forgetting a Zone 1 tube ticket when you arrive.
But with Business Advance, you get all these extras free
for less than a first class return.
Welcome aboard.
Intercity Business Advance. Think about it.
Speak.
They're on their way.
Right. Just how good is it?
See for yourself.
It's better than we thought. We must stop it.
Ladies and gentlemen, dinner is served.
The new Almira, the car they don't want you to drive.
I'm about to make a very big commitment in my life. Things are going to be different.
What, you found your wallet then?
I'm having to stick the car in the paper.
No one's going to buy it.
You might as well wrap it in paper.
I'm going to get an estate car.
Real nice sign, Norman, no mates in the front.
You just know when the time is right. I want to just go for it.
But what's the reason, then?
Because I love
her. A nice one.
Hello? Hello? No, my battery's going.
Yeah, we nearly finished. I'll be home about six. Yeah, love you too.
Yellow Pages, supporters of the Granada match live.
Welcome back. Still 70-odd goals to come on the Granada match live this afternoon, but right now it's off to Liverpool. It's news and Premiership time with Soh Rahman.
Thanks, Elton. Army firefighters tackled over 200 incidents on Merseyside yesterday. They were covering for regular fire crews who were on a 24-hour strike. Despite concerns about the ability of the soldiers in aging green goddesses to cope on the eve of bonfire night, there were no serious injuries. A major search is underway for a 15-year-old boy missing in a river estuary in Lancashire. He set out with a friend from Southport to cross the Ribble estuary to Lytham at low tide yesterday. His friend was rescued last night. The estuary is wide with dangerous sands. Football now, and here's Ken Daly with yesterday's Premiership action.
If you arrived late and left early, you'd have missed the goals, but there was much to savour in between. Luck was certainly with Newcastle. Keith Gillespie's miss-hit shot turned in by Les Ferdinand. Liverpool's equaliser looked similar, but miss-hit it certainly wasn't. It was pass and move at its very best. Steve McManaman's shot, Ian Rush turning it in. Liverpool have proved many times what Bill Shankly said about a game lasting 90 minutes. This time, the ball was on the other foot, or more precisely, David James's leg, as it rolled perfectly for Steve Watson's injury time winner. Manchester United lost for the first time since the opening day when Dennis Bergkamp, named after Dennis Law, beat Dennis Irwin. Peter Schmeichel then produced one of the saves of the season to keep an Ian Wright header out, and even Wright, a man whose hands are more noted for rather less sportsmanlike use on the field, had to show his admiration. Now, who's this nimble-footed midfield maestro at Main Road? None other than Niall Quinn, starting a flowing move, Giorgio King-Clancy then wrong-footing everybody, and Nicky Simmerby scoring City's first goal in 8 league games. But where is the Bolton defence? Now, this is the same thing, but at twice the speed. Juninho appeared in the Premiership at last and certainly didn't disappoint. His beautifully weighted pass set up Jan-Arne Fjørtoft, and his finish was worthy of the Maracana, never mind Middlesbrough.
That's it for now. Back to Elton in Manchester.
Thanks a lot, So. Also from the Premiership this afternoon, latest score from Goodison Park, Everton leading there by a goal to nil, Graham Stewart. Right, West Brom against Leicester now. Now, you might remember Leicester were 3-0 up at half-time. Whoever won this game will go second in the First Division this evening. The second half highlights with Alan Parry.
It's Hamilton going forward for West Brom. Pressure certainly on them in terms of the scoreline. Gilbert's cross. Taylor coming in far post. It comes for Hamilton. A mistake by the Leicester defenders has suddenly given West Bromwich Albion a glimmer of hope. Ian Hamilton scoring. This ain't over yet. As another dangerous cross comes in and the keeper's lost it again. What a mishmash of a goal is it? It is. West Brom have got one back.
Well, the mishmash of a goal didn't really matter as it happened, so Leicester do go second this evening, and we'll take a full check on the table once we've seen all the action from the First Division. That's the cue for the avalanche of goals, which begins right now. And yesterday saw the most accomplished performances by both Tranmere and Stoke so far this season. Jim Beglin.
Tranmere wanted revenge for their five-goal mauling at the baseball ground on Easter Monday. That was the beginning of the end of last season's push for promotion, and Pat Nevin's clever finish gave them the ideal start. It was one of those days when every one of Johnny King's men were up for it. Confident, sharp and incisive, almost inevitably, the in-form Ian Moore got in on the act with a sixth goal in five games. Then, just past the half-hour mark, the young pretender turned provider for the old master, Moore easily beating his man in the corner before picking out John Aldridge to steer home his 10th goal of the season. A debut for Derby's new signing, Croatian centre-back Igor Stimac, had an unsettling effect on the Rams' defence, but it was he who tried to inspire a comeback 7 minutes after the restart. But Tranmere are looking a more resilient outfit these days. They denied their visitors a chance to get right back into the match with some solid defending until Gary Bennett's determination made the game safe 10 minutes from time. Indeed, it was youngster Ian Moore who'd supplied Bennett, and he then claimed his third assist out of Tranmere's five goals by picking out John Aldridge once more. The Rovers captain completing the rout. Stoke's first against Luton was further proof that their quality of football is fast improving. Keeping possession while looking for an opening, Paul Pesci-Solido found it in 15 minutes. But surprisingly, they had to wait for almost an hour before finding the net again. Substitute Simon Sturridge beating the Luton offside trap and remaining cool when it mattered most. Within 2 minutes, another sub had a save too. This time, Big John Gale tried his luck from all of 25 yards and a speculative effort sneaked past Luton keeper Tony Feuer. By now, the Luton defence was all over the place, allowing Ray Wallace to run clear and set up the easiest of finishes for Sturridge to tap home his second. And to complete the Hatters' misery, Nigel Gleghorn got the luck of the bounce to side-foot Stoke's fifth in the very last minute. After this display, Lou McCarrie's search for a goal scorer may well be put on hold.
Right, nationwide now, starting with the leaders Millwall away to Birmingham, here's Mike Sadler.
23,000 packed into St Andrews for the game of the day, and a perfectly executed set piece saw Steve Castle give the home side a 1-0 lead at the break. The Blues must have thought they were heading for top spot, but Mick McCarthy's decision to bring on Kerry Dixon changed all that, and Millwall's unbeaten away record in the league was destined to remain intact. And they almost snatched the points 5 minutes from time. Alex Ray is claiming the second, though admittedly with a little deflection help. A late equaliser saved the Blues' blushes, though there was more than a little embarrassment for Tony Whitter, whose mistake allowed Ken Charlery to give Barry Fry's side a share of the points. But we'll have to see what happens about reports of a pitch invasion. It's not getting much better for Graham Taylor, but the Yorkshireman continued to impress. The impressive Martin Bullock setting up Neil Redfern for the only goal of the game. Now, five home wins in the league would suggest Brian Horton's men are enjoying life in Division 1, and they're scoring plenty of goals. Ronnie Jepson claiming the first in a manner Malcolm McDonald would have been proud of. They went two up just after the break. Good work by Paul Dalton on the left exposed the Norwich defence. Steve Jenkins converted, and Huddersfield looked set for a fairly comfortable 3 points. But Martin O'Neill's side rallied well, responding with two goals in 12 minutes. First, Darren Eadie's persistence and telling cross set up Ashley Ward's sliding effort. And it was same again for the second. Eadie to Ward, this time the lofted version, exactly where a centre-forward wants it, sweetly met. Perhaps Norwich had settled for a point, and Brian Gunn's failure to hold the ball 8 minutes from time was punished by the man quickest to react, Paul Dalton, capping a fine game with a cheeky winner. Goals certainly weren't in short supply, and Portman Road was no exception. Paul Mason scored twice for Ipswich. Mind you, he was allowed the freedom of the Grimsby defence for his first. His second also profited from a lack of marking. Ian Marshall climbed well to set him up, one Liverpudlian to another. Mason's second bite perhaps a little harsh on the goalkeeper Paul Crichton. But the visitors regrouped to good effect, and they got their rewards with two goals in the space of just 7 minutes. Neil Woods pounced on Maurizio Tirico's mistake. Head tennis got Grimsby back in the match. And another header, and a high-quality one at that, earned them a point. Perfect timing from Jim Dobbin, keeping Grimsby just ahead of their opponents in the table. Another four goals to entertain a crowd of 7,000 at Watford. The visitors started the scoring through a well-judged, well-placed header from Dave Regis, that one after just 5 minutes. But Glenn Roeder's men returned the compliment midway through the first half. Not the greatest of goals, but Darren Caskey was happy to see a timely deflection help the ball past Simon Royce. And it was the same story in the second half. Southend taking an early lead. This time, Paul Reid it was, with the right sense of timing. But the home fans didn't have to wait long for the leveller. Tommy Mooney did the damage on the left-hand side, and his well-weighted cross was gratefully met by Kevin Phillips. Still, Watford remained firmly in the bottom five. Palace's indifferent home form continues. They've now lost three times at Selhurst Park in the league. Richard Shaw's horrendous error couldn't have given them a worse start, and Reading took full advantage. That came within the quarter hour, and 10 minutes later, the game really was over. Reading's first away victory from Elm Park secured by Lee Nogan. Two sides desperate for points, and it was the visitors who started the more confidently. The ex-Manchester City midfielder Fitzroy Simpson putting them ahead at Bramall Lane. But Dave Bassett's teams aren't usually pushovers, and their traditional fighting qualities surfaced quickly and decisively before half-time. Route one for goal one, Carl Viet with the first of two in the afternoon. And just a couple of minutes later, they were ahead. It was made by one of the oldest men on the pitch, 32 years of age. Glyn Hodges there setting up Jostein Flo, and the Blades beginning to find the cutting edge. Goal number three was another Dave Bassett trademark, a practiced free kick into the area. Dave Tuttle for Carl Viet to follow up. And to wrap up, back to route one. Defences just can't cope with constant aerial bombardment. Substitute Tony Battersby, the easiest of tap-ins.
Well, Dave Bassett's boys are back in action. There's one result from this afternoon. Charlton Athletic 1, Sunderland 1. Sunderland coming from behind, which means they actually take Tranmere's place, fourth place in the first division, moving up one. Rovers fifth now. Oldham ninth as a result of their point this afternoon. And just to confirm at the bottom that Port Vale have taken Luton's place in 23rd position. Port Vale off the bottom thanks to their point. We'll be back after the break.
I can't see a thing.
Hey, what pair are these? They're called glasses. Look, give us your address. We'll drop you off a pair. You want bifocals?
Yellow Pages, supporters of the Granada Match Live.
Put in the tape, and you have 1 hour to stop the Gatekeeper. The video board game Atmosphere, the Harbingers. It'll change the way you play games forever.
When I finish shopping, you know the first thing I do before I even unpack? I have a Magnum. Well, why not?
I always have my Magnums tucked away in the freezer.
When the phone rings, I let it ring. It's my moment.
I have this nightmare. I go to the freezer for a Magnum and they're all gone.
I love the blue fabric softener freshness my Bold gives me.
I love the yellow fabric softener freshness my Bold gives me.
But if after a time I get used to it and fancy a change, Bold gives me a choice of softeners so I can enjoy a new kind of freshness all over again.
Bold, the choice is refreshing.
Morning, Jed,
said the girls as young Jed strode lustily home.
I've made my mind up, Mother, I'm leaving home.
My grannions are yearning for Italy and all it affords.
Slow down your snoot. This'll fret you, wanderlust boy. Pasta made smuckling with Coleman's new spicy tomato sauce.
So, his manly appetite frailed, Jed strode out to admire the Norfolk Broads. Pasta passion, smuckling new sauces from Coleman's of Norwich.
Don't ever go out without Sympatex. The invisible, high-performance membrane built into clothes to come between you and the elements with maximum protection. Waterproof. Breathable. Windproof. So, whatever the weather, you're safe. Sympatex. Look for the blue triangle.
What, how do you know?
Left the label on.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Yellow Pages, supporters of the Granada Match Live.
Welcome back onto the second division, and certainly Blackpool didn't suffer vertigo at the runaway leaders Swindon yesterday. Let's hear from Gary Bloom with all the details there in the second division, which we will very shortly. I thought we'd see it then, so did you, eh? Well, we've got third to come, and the second before that.
Swindon began the day with a 6-point lead at the head of Division 2.
Blackpool kept Swindon out for 50 minutes before Steve Finney scored the game's opening goal. But Blackpool secured a point via the penalty spot 20 minutes later. And Paul Bodin brought down Marvin Bryan. James Quinn drew the sides level at 1-1. And that's the way it ended. Mid-table Rotherham in red gave Crewe a game and a half. They chased Crewe all the way and took the lead 3 minutes in from the slightly fortunate Sean Gota. But Crewe settled to their task and ensured Rotherham's lead was short-lived. Rob Savage drew the side's level 10 minutes later. He was just a little pleased with his glancing header. And that's the way it stayed until the hour mark, till Paul Blades, hardly a prolific scorer in his Derby, Norwich or Wolves days, made it 2-1 to the home side. But Crewe's never-say-die commitment paid off handsomely, and with just 3 minutes left of this topsy-turvy game, they found a deserved equaliser from centre-half Steve McCauley, who rescued Crewe from what would have been their third defeat of the season. Just 2 points separated Burnley and Notts County at the start of the day. Burnley pressed the fast-forward button from the start and took the lead 4 minutes in through Kurt Nogan. The home side's lead lasted just 12 minutes. Notts County, who are mounting a determined promotion challenge, were level through Vinnie Arkins. Notts County took the lead in this match for the first time 8 minutes from half-time when they were awarded a penalty. Paul Devlin was fouled by Peter Swan. Devlin took the spot kick himself to make it 2-1 to the away side. Well, this proved to be the decisive moment of the match when Notts County, who haven't scored that many away goals this season, raced into a two-goal lead as Ian Barraclough made it 3-1 on the hour mark. Burnley rallied though and pulled a goal back from Andrew Cook 9 minutes later. Burnley were desperately trying to avoid going down to their first home defeat of the season. Notts County were determined to keep up the pressure on Swindon and Crewe at the head of the table and killed off any lingering hopes Burnley might have had of rescuing a point with this goal from Paul Devlin, his second of the match. Burnley refused to be battered into submission and this late goal from Kurt Nogan ensured Notts County had an uncomfortable last 5 minutes as they hung on for their 4-3 success. Fans had to be patient to wait for the first goal of this game, and it came the way of bottom-of-the-table Hull City, who prior to this match had only won once in the league this season. Greg Abbott scored 6 minutes from full-time. Wrexham have managed to come from behind 9 times this season to take a share of the spoils. Mark McGregor left it late with this equaliser, came a minute from full-time. Stockport's away form is better than their home form this season, so no surprise they were in command at struggling York. Michael Oliver scored the opening goal of the game for Stockport just after half-time. And Stockport took a two-goal lead from Ian Helliwell as County went seeking their fourth away victory of the season. York's defending is nothing to write home about. Paul Barnes, whose goals destroyed Manchester United in the Coca-Cola Cup, was to have a major say in this game. He converted a penalty following Connolly's foul on Matthews. And Barnes wasn't finished yet, as he secured a second York goal 20 minutes from full-time to earn his side a point.
Well, now to the summit of Division 3, the country's top scorer is Preston with Mike Sadler.
Preston sit proudly at the top of the table today, thanks mainly to another hat-trick from Andy Saville, his first lesson in never-say-die poaching, and they simply got better. They all came in the second half, and in between, Graham Atkinson's Power Ranger had set up a third in three games for Simon Davey. Once again, the North End players simply quicker to react to danger. The defence was nowhere. Goal number three was also a product of poor defending, and that in many ways was the story of the afternoon for Leighton Orient. Ian Hendon's error let Saville in, and in this mood, that's costly. His finish oozed confidence. By now, Gary Peters' side were well on their way to their fourth consecutive victory at Deepdale, but not before Saville pushed his season's tally to 14 with another contender for goal of the month. That is unstoppable. It's not hard to see why Torquay have the worst defensive record in the division, and Chester took full advantage. Cyril Regis there heading home to start things off at the Divas Stadium. But the second had more than a hint of controversy surrounding it. I'm not sure the visitors would agree that Andy Milner was onside, but he didn't ask any questions. The third goal, as Chester coasted to league win number 9, came courtesy of Spencer Whelan. But to their credit, Torquay came back and managed to force a goal themselves as reward for the handful of travelling fans who'd made the long journey. Sheer determination kept the attack going for Ellis Lake to score. But it was nothing more than a consolation. Andy Milner was felled from behind, and Kevin Noteman converted the ensuing penalty. Chester move into second spot. It took just 2 minutes for Mick Doherty's side to seize the advantage at Glanford Park, or perhaps it was handed to them, Mark Stewart accepting the invitation. The second, though, as Dale eased towards their fifth away league win, was a crafted goal. A move he started saw Kevin Formby overlap to provide Steve Whitehall with the simplest of tap-ins. Scunthorpe, though, weren't about to lie down. They certainly battled, and some might say a little over-enthusiastically. I know a few refs who'd certainly have given keeper Ian Gray the vote over Tony Ford there. But it proved academic. Despite an anxious last 6 minutes or so, all's well that ends well. No argument over the third. Steve Whitehall's finish impeccable. With 5 goals in his last 2 games, Phil Stant was ready for more. Sadly, though, it wasn't his day. Some Bury fans thought he could have had a penalty there, and maybe should have had, just minutes later. But the ref decided otherwise. Matty Appleby escaped punishment. Gig Lane remained goalless, and Bury slipped just a little further off the pace. A new manager at Springfield Park, but John Dean won't have been happy there with the defending from the corner that allowed Terry Angus to give Fulham the lead after half an hour. Still, at least Dean saw his side's ability to bounce back and take a point just 10 minutes later. Far from a classic, but John Robertson will settle for that as his first of the season.
I'll tell you, we're all breathless after that little lot. Now, Andy, you saw our end finally of last week, an extraordinary goal. By George Parris here, playing for Brighton against Bristol Rovers, which was deemed to be illegal on about half a dozen counts, and you reckon he should have been sent off for 2 yellow cards, one going off the pitch and one for coming back on. Now, this is Robbie Painter of Darlington, yesterday against Gary Kelly of Bury. Now, he got booked for that because presumably the goalkeeper had control of the ball, but it reminded us of this incident from 5 years ago. Remember this, Andy?
I do. I remember Andy Dibble's reaction to it. It was a smashing face he pulled.
Well, that was Gary Crosby, of course, and Andy Dibble in goal for Manchester City, who certainly wasn't happy. Now, do you think that everyone got it right there, do you?
Well, in my opinion, I don't think the three of the goals should be allowed. Nothing should be allowed like that. I think that's, the referee must look away and not see the ball being played out of the hands.
Right. Okay, well, unlike you, Andy, Michael Jennings of Oldham actually got the score right at Boundary Park this afternoon, 2-2, as opposed to your 3-1. And we have more football coming up on Granada on Wednesday night. Well, Monday night, first off, the Anzi League Extra, Monday 12:40, which includes an in-depth look at Chester. And then soccer night, there we go, on Wednesday. Later than usual at 11:30, Tranmere, Birmingham. And the other one as well. Well, there we go. That's all we got time for this afternoon. Thanks for joining us, Andy. 2-2 it was at Boundary Park on the live match. Bye-bye.